Welcome to the 2 plus 2 Pokercast presented.
Oh my god,
right,
that's the first time.
That's the first time.
That's the very first time I did it.
I'm impressed. It took
wow.
You would have thought it would have happened in week one.
Yeah.
You would have thought it happened.
We are not presented by anybody currently. I am your host, Dave Schwartz, alongside Mr. T Chan's fine downtown apartment, and also Roscoe P. Coltrane on the ones and twos.
He's pressing buttons over there.
What's up, white boy? I eat grass.
Drop. And
too quiet.
This week we are joined by Mr. Ansky, Mr. Dani Stern. Welcome to the show, sir, again.
Thanks for having me.
There we go. Get your mic going.
Adjust
there.
Your mic.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, so this is fun. August evening in
we finally got some good weather. I've been back. I came back a little bit late from the World Series, and I just had nothing. We had nothing but clouds.
There was a lot of clouds
last week, and now it's that beautiful time that we come. You know, Donnie, we were at the sushi bar, which I guess is a place that you're frequently found. Just talking about how you, in your opinion, Vancouverites do not appreciate the beauty of their own city.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I said that. yeah, like when you're walking down the street in Vancouver and a lot of neighborhoods, you have like just ridiculously beautiful views. You can see the mountains, the beach, you know, the bay, and
all anybody can talk about here is rain, right? Like anybody
rain's coming
is like rain and rising real estate prices.
Yeah, those are the two.
That's all we can talk.
Congrats
about.
On becoming a landed immigrant in Canada.
Thank
is that
you.
A long process? Is that a big thing?
It's a lot of paperwork. It's not like, it's not that difficult per se. You know, I didn't have to get interviewed or anything like that. But it was an enormous amount of paperwork to fill out, and then you fill it out and you file it, and then you're just at the mercy of the Canadian government. You have to just wait.
You just didn't wait. How long did it take?
From the time we filed till the time I got it back, it was like maybe 5 months.
Okay.
But the process of like getting all the paperwork together took quite a while because, you know, you have to put together all this information about your relationship and your marriage.
Right.
And then my wife had to get like these tax forms that took forever for the government to give back to her. And so it just kind of, you know, it's just like a government bureaucratic mess.
Right.
It's really, it's amusing to me though, because you were just mentioning, I think I heard while, just before we started recording that like, they require proof that your relationship is it like a real relationship, that you're not just, you didn't just marry her.
They start off with that that assumption, right? Okay, this isn't real. Prove to us that it's real.
Yeah,
is basically how it's done, right?
Yeah, you have to. Yeah, so like I had to take like pictures or like screenshots of like itineraries from like our flight records from like 3 years ago, showing that we took a trip to Hawaii together.
Right,
like
right, right.
Earlier last year, we took a trip to
Japan.
Did
they make
Japan
you produce
together.
Like pictures from Hawaii?
Yes,
like, you
yes,
know, like you're, look, we're really in love. Like, look,
yeah,
look how no, much we're enjoying the sunset, right? Kind of thing.
Yes, yeah. Literally. Yes.
Yeah.
Like, we have to like, pictures. Like, our lawyer was basically like, yeah, okay, so do you have a picture that has like, from Facebook, that has like a
timestamp
on it that,
wow,
that verifies the, you know, that trip you took. But to be clear, I think what we all this was like extreme overkill. Like, you know, I think this, like we had a pretty serious lawyer for all this, and like tons of people do this without a lawyer. But I really wanted the process to be done like as fast as possible and just be over with and not have to have this drag out for years or worry. Cause one of the things is that like, it's all done by mail. And like, if you fill out the application, you screw something up, you know, they might just 4 months later be like, okay, you have to start all over again.
Oh,
you know? And
yeah.
And so I didn't want to have any risk of that happening. Plus, I was already getting just like viciously harassed at the border every time. So I wanted to just be done as fast as possible.
Right. Wow. So your wife is from Toronto, is that correct?
Yeah.
And why did you choose Vancouver then?
She doesn't really like Toronto that much.
Really?
Oh, wow.
Yeah. She really hates the cold. Like, really hates
okay.
the cold. Like, once the temperature drops below, like, I don't know, like 4 Celsius or something.
Right.
It doesn't matter how warm she dresses. She's just always freezing.
Okay.
Like, there's nothing you can
so
do.
So she's been
it.
Looking to get out of there for a while.
Yeah. Well, yeah. we left Toronto and then moved to Mexico for
mm-hmm.
a year and a half.
She loved that.
Yeah. That was, you know,
nice
both,
and warm. Yeah.
Yeah. Both loved living in Playa del Carmen and living by the beach. So.
Did you not? Did you just sort of think that, like, because you know, obviously, you know, you're a Black Friday refugee, more or less, mm-hmm. and you could have been anywhere in the world, Canada, Mexico, Europe. Was So is the Vancouver thing just sort of a matter of convenience with respect to the fact that you can legally live here and do all that? Like, why aren't you still in Mexico or in Europe or somewhere like
yeah,
that?
Yeah, I think you touched on it. It's the idea is that this is a potential, at least, for being a permanent home.
Mm-hmm.
You know, living in Playa del Carmen was really fun, but it didn't feel very adult-like, I guess.
Yeah,
like
it's, I can
it,
imagine.
You know, it was just kind of like, this is cool, but like, you know, we're not going to like raise children here or something like that.
Sure.
You know, not that we're, you have children yet, but still, like, it's something like thinking like long-term. You know, you want something that's a little bit more permanent, a little bit more of like an actual real home.
Yeah.
I never quite felt at home in Playa, you know. My Spanish was not very good, and it's just kind of a crazy place to live.
Yeah. Well, we have to have all that regulation here to so we don't have to build a wall. There's no wall being built, so to keep the Americans out.
Yeah. Who's going to run on that platform? The Conservative Party of Canada is going to run to keep all of our southern, you know,
yeah.
They're stealing all of our online poker jobs.
That's right.
You know, we would have different high-stakes online poker players if we didn't let guys like Donnie into the country. You know, we'd have our own homegrown Canadian.
We touched on a couple times when you were on the show before. I was fascinated by the fact that you'd taken culinary school and you'd gone and become a chef. And I wonder, because we've had David Williams on MasterChef, at which I watched. Have you watched?
I watched a couple of the episodes. I really enjoyed watching David on there, and I'm a pretty big Gordon Ramsay fan. You know, I enjoy his
shtick.
Yeah, his shtick. But I got to be honest, like, I find that show to be intolerably terrible. Like, it is
the cooking itself?
No, not the cooking. Just the reality show aspect of
it.
It's like all fluff. Like, there's no substance at all.
Right.
It's just like all reality show garbage. And it's just, you know, and no disrespect to David at all. It's obviously not his doing. Like I said, I really enjoyed watching him on there and I like him. But it's just like, it's just the bottom of the barrel of like, you know, intelligence, quality of programming. It's just pure idiocy.
As opposed to those really highly intelligent reality TV shows. That
yes.
Are there any?
Other than
yeah, I can think of one.
What's that? Yeah,
exactly. Too much familiar. It's funny, we were having sushi before doing the show, and you guys were talking some MMA, and Donnie, you were saying that the old 2 months, 2 million house is the house that they filmed The Ultimate Fighter in.
Yeah, at least, I'm not certain it still is, but it was as of like a couple of years ago. Yeah, they kind of, it doesn't look exactly like our house, but when you see like the B-roll shots of like panning out from the outside, like you can tell it's
the same door.
House, yeah.
And you've started rolling around on the mat yourself. You're doing some training, right?
Yeah. I've been doing jujitsu for about a week now.
It's been a week.
Yeah. I wouldn't say I'm. I mean,
on a scale of 1 to 10, how sore are you today? Like in this exact moment?
I'm only like a 5 out of 10 right now.
That's pretty good, because usually your first week is pretty terrible. But
yeah, I mean, I'm like bruised everywhere, and my back hurts. But yeah, you know, it's not like that much worse than the day after going to like a CrossFit class or something. You know,
right?
It's different. It's not like I'm not like as sore muscle wise. I'm just more bruised.
I think there's also the sense that when you're a total raw beginner, like a lot of the guys that are experienced, like take it a little more easy on you.
Yeah.
So like 3 months from now, I'd really love to check in and sort of see how you're feeling now. That when because you're a big dude and you're a strong dude, obviously, like when you're to the point where you start putting other people in danger and they start fighting back really hard, then your life will really suck.
Okay. Yeah.
Something to look forward to.
I'm going to keep doing this. You know, I've very, very lightly done some some boxing classes in the past, but nothing too serious. But this gym is like, I mean, you know, it's the gym you train at.
Yeah.
It's like a serious fighting gym, and so I think this would be like a different experience. And I do plan on going to like some of the kickboxing classes too. But yeah, I'm going to take this seriously for at least the next like few months.
Nice. And I'm glad you've got the bug. Like, I'm excited. Yeah. I've always said that like if martial arts had an affiliate program, I'd be like super rich and I could just retire off of that because I've gotten so many people in. But I do it for free because I just love
it's just really fun.
Yeah,
like, I mean, like, especially like I think most guys who grew up playing sports, you know, and just like, you know, having a bunch of like guy friends who you just like wrestle with and just like play fight, like, you know, like I still like wrestle with my friends, you know. I'm 29 years old.
Yeah.
It's
great. It's just super cathartic, right?
Yeah.
It's just
it's
to
fun.
Be able to just go in there and just like, oh, I'm going to like wrestle against this guy.
And jujitsu itself, even compared to like boxing, I think one of the guys because my wife is doing it too. And one of the guys told her
your wife is super into it. Yeah. She is like I've been really impressed. Like she is gung ho about it.
Yeah, yeah. No, she's like she basically pushed me into it because she started like a couple weeks before me, mm-hmm. and I was like, you have to do this. We're doing this together. This is a thing, you know. So I was just like,
right.
Well, I can't let you beat me up and like
yeah, that would
so,
be bad.
Yeah. So I have to learn. And like somebody told her that I'm trying to remember the exact wording that jiu-jitsu is like high intensity violent chess,
yeah,
or something
sounds
like that.
Right.
Really tactical.
And yeah. it makes sense because basically you're just like constantly being put in these positions, and there's an answer, like there's right. a way out, you know. There's and you have to figure it out, and then like you start doing it, and then the other person's now his situation's changed, and he has to like counter you, and it's just it's all very like puzzle solving.
Yeah, very much so. Like I can put you in a situation where you can, you know, you can roll towards me or you can roll away from me. Say if you roll towards me, maybe I'll attack your arm, and if you roll away from me, I'll attack your neck. And it's sort of it's a lot like chess in that sort of a situation. Like if I fork you with a knife, it's like, well, shoot, I have to decide whether I'm going to lose this piece or that piece. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to. I did something wrong earlier in the game, and now I'm stuck in this bad situation. So I'm glad you're on board with the program.
When's your fight with Olivia?
That's a good Olivia can pick on somebody's
right?
own size.
Similar size guys.
Olivia
right?
can pick on somebody's own size.
No, thank you. I'm not into at least not for a long time. I'm not into it for that purpose. I'm not like
right.
actually interested in like
that might come like, later. Yeah,
the violence aspect of it. I'm in sure. for the sport and. Yeah,
we had you back on the show in December, and we were talking about the stuff that was going on at PokerStars, the Supernova League changes, etc. You were quite vocal about that, and I wonder now that we can kind of look back on it. It's been 6, 7, 8 months. What are your current feelings about exactly how it all went down? What's happened in the interim?
I mean, I still very much don't feel good about the way it went down. I'm not happy, but at the same time, I mean, like, you know, I can only be angry for so long. I don't know, like, where to direct my anger at this point. And I'm, you know, fundamentally, like, I'm a professional poker player, and most of my energy and time that I spend in my life is spent around trying to become a better professional poker player and doing that. So, you know, I've kind of moved on in that sense that you know, For like a period of a month in like December and January, like all I was doing was like trying to like actively like fight for what I thought was like, you know, fight for poker players basically, and it was very exhausting, and it, like I, you know, it took time out of my own like career, so I kind of at some point had to just go back to my own normal life, and so I guess I don't think about it actively too much, but I. You know, I think we're just kind of in the new reality now, and. It was like a hard transition to go from knowing that PokerStars kind of like had our back, the poker community, to now we're in whatever this position is. I don't know what our relationship with them is.
It's not antagonistic, but it's certainly not. It doesn't feel as symbiotic as it used to, right?
Yeah, and I'm not sure it's not antagonistic. I don't know. I'm just I don't really know. You know what I'm supposed to, how I'm supposed to feel about it, basically. And I, like I said, I guess I'm devoting most of my energy just being a poker player, and not so much the politics of all this. You know, I don't know what's going to happen going forward, but I can only imagine that PokerStars is going to keep doing things like they did. Hopefully. Hopefully they won't cross any more lines of actively deceiving players like the way they did the Supernova and Supernova Elite stuff. And, you know, I think they would argue that they didn't actively deceive players. They
miscommunicated.
They passively deceive players right. would be what they said, but, you know, whatever. It's semantics, I guess.
Yeah.
Do you worry about? I mean, obviously, I guess everybody to some extent worries about it. But to what extent do you worry about sort of your career as an online professional poker player? You're one of the very best in the world, but at some point, you know, if you know, you alluded to, you think that a Mayan PokerStars will continue to go down this road. I mean, what do you think your career is as an online poker pro?
Yeah, I mean, I'm certainly worried. I don't take it for granted the fact that. you know, at any point, someone at PokerStars could make a decision that could, like, radically impact my life.
Right.
I'm very aware of that fact, you know. And it's been that way for a while, and I don't love it, but I also, you know, I can't worry about things you can't control. Exactly. I can't do anything about that. So for right now, I know that I'm going to be playing, you know, 25, 50 to 200, 400 PLO for the next, like, at least a year, probably.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully 3 years, ideally 5 years. I mean, I have absolutely no idea what kind of timeline we're looking at.
Right.
So you've had about 8 or 9 months since the changes that have come in 2016. You mentioned that you do play the biggest online games at PokerStars and PLO. Of course, there's no VIP program anymore above 510. What have you noticed as far as the games go? Have you noticed a big change? Obviously, it's going to be cyclical when you get up games that big anyway. Mm-hmm. But do you think it's is there anything there with cause and effect?
I mean, I don't really have my, you know, fingers to the pulse of, like, the low stakes and mid stakes games, but at least at high stakes, I'd say volume is down, but not. I'm not even certain that volume is down, because, like, at the beginning of the year, there was a lot of action, and then it kind of slowed down. It's always hard to tell, like, I'm not keeping active track of how many hands everyone's played, but, you know, and like right now, it's August. August is always, like, really dead, so it's, like, pretty quiet right now. Also, like, my year this year has been a little bit different than other years, you know. I'm mostly playing against professional poker players, which is kind of independent of all this, you know. And, you know, when I'm playing a 100, 200 match for somebody, were we ever, you know, concerned with the VPPs involved? Probably not, but, you know, it certainly doesn't help that the effective rake has gone up, as long as it's, you know, still manageable. We're going to keep playing, obviously.
Sure.
Until we move to another site, but...
Well, one place that does keep track, you said you didn't keep track, is a high-stakes database. I don't know if you spend any time looking at the site. I imagine you may be looking at competitors and stuff. You're the biggest winner in PLO of the year at this moment in time. Did you know that?
I didn't know that. Yeah. I had a really bad day the other day. Are you sure?
Oh, did
you?
As of today, you looked it up today. Yeah,
okay.
I looked it as of today. Omaha for Rolls is second,
okay.
Close behind you. Do you have a lot of interaction with him, her?
Him. I've met him in real life, and I've played a lot with him on Stars.
And Isildur is the number three PLO guy this year, on according to Isaac.
Your face suggests that you're surprised by this.
No, I guess Isildur, I mean, he always seems like, he's gone, because he disappears for a while, but then he somehow is always, like, the biggest winner or biggest loser in every single game.
it's one or the other.
Yeah.
We could do the show again next week, and he'll be, like, third on the losing list and stuff.
Yeah, I noticed that you had 358 sessions this year. Again, this is... high-stakes database. I don't know how accurate it is, but if it is accurate, 358 sessions at Stars this year with 23,000 hands played, which takes us to, I think, about 70 hands per session or something average, which I was a bit surprised at. I thought that was kind of low.
I'm not sure how they count sessions, though. That might be like if I'm playing somebody on two or three tables heads up, and then we break up the stacks on one table because we're playing too deep
or our count balance
is low or something.
Oh, I see.
And it might count that as, like, a new session. It might be, like, that might be
right.
Table sessions.
Gotcha.
So I'm not sure if that's a relevant piece of information. But, you know, I'd say my average session is something like 400 hands.
400 hands.
Maybe. I don't know. It depends on, you know, if I'm playing Zoom, like, 6-max Zoom, I could easily play, like, 1,500 hands without getting up to pee or whatever.
Right.
That's not too hard.
Right.
That goes really fast, and especially if you're 4-tabling. That you know, I've played 5,000-6,000 hands in a day of that, no problem. If I'm playing, like, heads up against a really good opponent, I usually don't play more than 2 tables. Sometimes I'll play 3, and I play pretty slow. So with that, I'll probably usually go no more than, like, 500 or 600 hands in a session, and
gotcha.
Then I'll need to take a break at least. You know, sometimes I'll go a little more.
In the heads-up games, do you get a lot of shot takers or just randoms that show up, or is it going to be other pros and regs that show up? Like, how often do you get some guy you've never seen before or some guy who normally plays way lower and just jump in the 100, 200 PLO heads up against you or something.
Pretty close to never.
Oh, yeah?
Okay. I mean, it's not never. Like, it does happen sometimes. I'd say that happens at, like, 25, 50 a lot more regularly. And then at 50, 100, or, like, a little bit less. And then 100, 200, like, virtually never happens. Hmm. It's for the most part, people that I'm very familiar with, that I've played lots of hands with.
Right.
Like, my most common opponent... would be somebody like Barry Sweet, and I've played more hands against him than anyone in my life. So,
oh wow!
You mentioned stack depth, which I thought was interesting. Is there a lot of players out there who, we're 200 big blinds deep now, I'm going to quit, start again? Is there a lot of managing stack depths when you're playing heads up? Especially if you're three tabling a guy, like
sure. I mean, some people don't like playing deep, and they'll say, if we get deep, I'm going to rat hole. Just letting you know.
So if they tell you that you're fine with it, kind of thing?
They can tell me or not tell me. I don't really care. It makes no difference to me.
Okay.
And I do the same thing. Sometimes I don't necessarily, you know, want to play somebody 400 big blinds deep at 100, 200. That's some pretty intense shit. I think a lot of players are sometimes comfortable. I mean, not everyone. Like, there's some guys who actually buy in 250 big blinds deep, and they think that their edge comes from being as deep as possible. And so, you know, guys like that probably are a little bit not as happy when people are rat-holing and trying to break up stacks. But then there's other people who buy in for the minimum and don't have auto rebuy on, and they're happy to, when stacks get down to, like, you know, 12 big blinds or whatever, and they want to play like that.
I can hear people out there saying, ask him who he thinks the best players are. It's the common question for these kind of interviews. We should probably ask it. Who
power rankings?
The power rankings. The top three power rankings.
You know, I think I'm retired from doing poker power rankings.
Okay. You don't have to,
I'll keep the sushi. Yeah. The thing is with poker power rankings is that you upset so many people because for every reason. Like, I remember I went out one time, when I was on Joe Ingram's podcast, I did power rankings, and like somebody I said was like really good messaged me and was like, "You idiot! Like, why did you say that?"
Really?
Like, yeah, not like you idiot, but like, come on, dude, don't tell people I'm good. And then like I remember somebody else I saw like in Vegas was just like, "Hey man, you didn't think I was in the top five?"
So like, so you really can't win either way.
No, I don't.
Including people.
I don't. I just don't.
I think that's.
Right. And it makes sense in like 2016. Like, I don't. You know.
Yeah, edges are so small.
There's just really no upside for you. Like, what is the possible upside?
I guess part of the upside, and I think this is what, like, Doug and his crew used to do, is that it's a way of talking shit to try to, like, rile up action. Be like, you're only the 15th best in the world. And that guy's going to be like, what? I'm definitely, like, the 11th best in the world. I have to prove myself. You know?
You mentioned Vegas. Of course, we've just come from the World Series of Poker. Give us a sort of a rundown of your World Series. How long were you down there for? What was your sort of PLO cash to tournaments breakdown? What was your goal this year?
I was down there a little bit over a month. I guess like a month and a half, maybe 6 weeks, something like that. I went down intending on playing more hours of PLO than tournaments, and I did do that. I'd say I probably broke down like 75% of my time playing cash, and it still did get in quite a few tournaments. I always think I'm always like, I'm going to play like five tournaments, and I always play like 12 or whatever. You know?
Yeah.
It always ends up happening.
It helps when you win two of them on back-to-back days for a combined 700,000.
Well, yeah, I did that. That was...
kind of helps.
But
you can't be too upset about that part.
No, but that was actually already at the point in the summer where I had sworn off tournaments I'm never playing a tournament again. And then,
Terrence has been there this year.
Yeah, and then I woke up and decided to play, and then... Yeah, then you know. Then I was just like, okay, I guess I can play some tournaments again.
Play another one. Nice. Yeah. What were the games like, the cash games? Were you playing the Aria, I guess, is the big game?
Mostly Bellagio.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think I played it at all at the Aria, actually, for cash. Bellagio is pretty... the games are pretty open. There's no politics, really, to get into play. And so, basically, Bellagio during the summer, you know, 25, 50, 50, 100 runs around the clock almost, and then 100, 200 PLO will run depending on the presence of certain players, and occasionally higher will run. I'd say this summer was a little bit lower stakes than last summer.
Really?
but still quite a bit. I still got in quite a bit of hands at 100, 200, 50, 100.
Is it a big switch when you go down there to play in those cash games after playing against those pros on PokerStars? You're playing, Zoom, playing fast heads up. Now you go sit in a game against a completely different player. How
Texas
hard is that
oil
for you?
Men. Do we get any Texas oil guys? Because I want to know if these guys still play like high stave live games. There's some guy from Texas with like a cowboy hat and likes playing PLO.
Yeah, there's those types. Yeah,
nice.
I don't know all of, like, their stories, like who is there for what reason. You know, some of the amateurs are very friendly and talkative with everyone and want to get to know everyone. And others seem to kind of want to keep themselves, so you leave them alone, basically. So I don't know like everyone's story, but. Yeah, I mean, it's a pretty big transition from playing online to playing those games. There is a different skill set involved, and like, there are some guys who kind of do well live who I don't think would do well online.
Sure.
And they definitely like get by doing some silly stuff that they can kind of get away with live because of, you know.
Like talkative, angle shooting, that kind of
thing? Yeah, I don't even want to say angle shooting, but just general, like, live stuff. Like, they're not, like, as fundamentally sound, but they...
Make up for it another way?
Yeah, it seems like they... I mean, they... I guess they make up for it. I'm not sure that they do. I definitely consider, like, the live games, like, much, much softer than online. Like,
so what kind of stuff, for example, would be something that a guy could...
Just, like, playing, like, way too many hands in every position and then thinking they can... They can just handle it because they're going to outplay people post-flop. And, like, yeah, people play worse, so you can probably play more hands. But
right.
I think, you know, they just take it too far or whatever. I mean, it's a very different game playing, like, eight-handed live PLO compared with, like, shorthand
right.
online.
When you're in a game like this, is something like, I mean, for lack of a better term, like fish management, like, you know, keeping the fish happy, these kind of things, is that something that... That you pay a lot of attention to, or is that something that a lot of these people that you're talking about do?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not like the best at like being like the guy in the like. I'm not getting invited to any private games or anything like that. I'm not like that like smooth with like talking to everyone. But I try to at least be very aware of all those types of things in the game.
Try not to like sit out when the guy goes to the bathroom.
Oh,
like that kind of ridiculous antisocial
of course
behavior.
Not.
Yeah,
and I think for the most part, the PLO players are all pretty fine about this. I don't really see too much like terrible bum hunter-y type behavior or like predatory stuff. I think probably there's something in like the nature of PLO that because it's such like a gambling game that like the regulars all have like I guess like a bit more willingness to take the worst of it sometimes or to like just
right.
kind of like gamble it up a little bit. Like in PLO, when you're like a slight loser in the game, it's not, or even when you're a big loser in a game, it's not like that obvious based on how the hands are going and stuff.
Right.
In No Limit, like you play a few sessions where you're getting outplayed by your opponents, like you know it. Like it's like, holy crap, these guys are just destroying me.
Right.
You know, it doesn't work like that in PLO. So I think that it clouds the field sort of, so like people are not entirely sure like who's winning and whatnot. So it creates like a better playing environment in PLO games. I spend a lot of time like sitting in the Bellagio and playing and observing other games like while I'm just sitting there, and I'd say like the PLO games, at least in what I see, are extremely friendly games. Like everybody's just kind of like a normal human being, and just like this topic of conversations are pretty like happy. And then like next to us will be like the mixed game players. And they're all like fucking psychos. Like they are insane people. Like
yeah.
they are just screaming at each other
yeah.
the entire time. Last year I saw a fight in a mixed game, like a fist fight.
Right.
I don't know too much about the No Limit games. They're probably somewhere in between.
Draw games.
Draw games.
Draw games.
Yeah.
Draw games make people insane. I don't
limit
really.
Games make people cranky.
I think. Yeah.
I think it's specific to limit.
Limit. It might be the specific limit. Might be specific.
Well, you look at the commerce. The most.
That terrible behavior.
Though. Yeah, it's all in the limit game generally.
Yeah, true.
But I don't know what it is about that. Do you have problems with or struggle with lifestyle when you're in Vegas? So you're there for a month and a half, but your buddies probably haven't seen you in a long time. Is it hard to stay focused and just play and play and play every day, or do you just kind of put it aside and put a couple days aside?
No, if anything, it's the opposite. Like when I'm in Vegas, all I do is play poker, basically.
Really?
I'm not, like, I'm not doing anything else. It's just, like, I know that this is just, like, a six-week work trip. That's how I consider it. If anything, I sometimes play too much, and I don't, like, take enough days off. I mean, I'm not, like, a partier. I don't go clubbing or anything like that.
No, no, yeah.
You know, like, I'm there to play poker, and I've always... Or I like go into it with that mentality, and you know, if anything, it's kind of hard to sometimes know when to stop, because when I'm like in it, when I'm in a game, sometimes you know, sometimes you get to Bellagio and there's no games running, or there's games and there's a long wait list, and it takes me an hour to get into any game at all, and then finally I'm in a game and I've been playing for like 10 hours, and like I'm getting kind of tired and the game's not that great, and it's like this, and I think to myself, like, this might be a good spot to just go home and go to sleep. On the other hand, I'm like, but there's all this downtime associated with getting into the game that I want to just, like, play as long as possible just to make it worth it.
Yeah.
And I kind of have to balance that, and I think I sometimes go too far to the side of just, like, always being, like, just play more.
Is it worth it to go down there for those games, considering you can be here, be anywhere in the world, and play online? Against presumably a softer field, I guess. If everybody's at the World Series, that might not be the case. But
it's tough because I mean games are pretty games don't run as much in the summer in online games don't run as much because so many people are in Vegas,
right?
In the summer at least. So I'm not certain, like EV wise, if it's like the best decision. But I've also just kind of accepted it as like. It's part of my yearly routine. I take a 6 week break from playing online to go down to Vegas and play live.
Probably recharges you playing online too, right?
Maybe. Yeah, it's a good break. It's a good. And the thing is, like, I'm always going to go down. At least, at the very least, I'm going to go down for like the last like 2 weeks of the World Series. Play the main event.
Yeah.
Play 25K PLO, 10K PLO, whatever. All the end of summer big tournaments. Play some 25Ks, the RA, whatever. So then it's really a question of, like, how early do I want to go?
How many hands of No Limit Hold'em did you play this year in Vegas?
Cash games?
Yeah.
Zero?
Zero?
Yeah.
And the main event was the only No Limit?
Actually, that's not true. I did play some 10-20 No Limit when I was waiting for a 50-100 PLO game once. No, I played quite a few No Limit tournaments.
No Limit tournaments?
Yeah, like, any of, like, the 5Ks and up, I'm...
You play, you're
I'm,
jumping in.
Not necessarily, but I'm liable to maybe play.
Can we ask you about some hands? I pulled some hands out of the... there's a high-stakes thread on 2+2. I don't know if you've ever...
Yeah, I'm familiar with it.
You've been around that?
Yes.
Looking at it. So I found a few that I thought were somewhat interesting.
Are these hands I played?
These are hands you played.
Okay.
I'm looking at these for the first time.
Oh, are you? Okay,
so,
good.
This will be fun.
You're playing three-handed with Vroom.
Vroom, yeah.
You're familiar with him. TJ Bentham. You have the big stack of the table. This is 50-100 PLO, and you are on the button. You raise to 410.
Are we going to tell the folks at home what he had? Or
yeah, let's tell them. You've got the jack-jack 9-3 with the jack-9 of clubs, and you raise. There's a fold. The big blind calls. 310 raise. So the flop comes ace-queen-8 all clubs. You flop a jack-high flush.
The second nut flush.
Ace, queen, eight. Mm-hmm. Vroom checks. You bet half pot. He raises. You call. Turn's a four. It's a blank. He bets. You call. River's another blank, a red six. He shoves and you call. So obviously it's an easy call in that spot with that hand. But I'm wondering why I picked this hand was he's got the king of clubs. He's got the naked club draw, I believe. Mm-hmm. Naked nut club. Club blocker. And... you're always calling with your hand, but I was curious about your calling range in that spot, given that you have the jack-eye flush you're going to call. But are you calling with sets? Is this opponent-specific? What kind of things go into your decision there for calling in the river without that hand?
So for the most part, I'm not folding, my big flushes. And I'm not folding my flushes with three clubs ever.
Okay.
Right.
Having the extra blocker power, stuff like a set with a big club is like a interesting spot. In these spots, your sidecars matter quite a lot.
Okay.
So basically, there's there's a lot of spots in PLO where there's like blocking and unblocking going on. There's all sorts of like cards you want your opponent to have and don't want him to have. This is like kind of an this is kind of like a pretty polar spot in this, in because he basically always just has like king of clubs or king high flush draw. You know, I'm not like, I was okay, so like his hand is a hand he can also call on the flop because he had ace king 9-10. So he doesn't necessarily need to check raise his hand. You know, he might have something like, so basically you can, if you think that he doesn't check raise with something like an offsuit ace and the king of clubs, in that sense, you don't want to block the ace. Or sorry, you, yeah, so when you, when you're on the river, you want to unblock the non-paired hands, basically. So like maybe I wouldn't call with, queens, but I'd call with aces. A set
oh, of, I see what you're saying. Right,
okay.
right.
But that's like, that's getting really like nitty gritty and probably like not actually that relevant in these spots.
Interesting. Yeah.
That's interesting because that shows me the level that you're thinking on, that it's, that you have to think about the hands that he would check raise with, you know, like he would, like you say, like it depends on whether he would check raise with ace king with the king of clubs specifically. Because it helps you play down the line. That's a very interesting.
Okay,
you want to know what the most important piece of strategy for that hand is?
Yes.
The most you can bet or raise is the size of a pot.
Thank you, Patrick.
that's awesome. All right, next hand is a 5100 hand against Lot Nice. You have 160 big blinds. You're playing deep. You have 160. He's got you covered. You're on the button and you raise with. Doesn't say what your hand does, but not really that important, I don't think, at this point. So a Lot Nice calls. The flop is 9-8-5 with two clubs. We see Lot Nice's hand. He's got 5-5-6-7 with the 5-6 of clubs. He flops the world, flops the nuts, straight flush redraw, and and bottom set. So we couldn't have hit him much harder than this. He checks, you bet, he raises, you call on the flop. The turn is a blank, three of hearts. Well, kind of a blank. He bets, you call. River pairs the board, three. He bets and you call, and he shows you the full house. I was wondering what your calling range here is, given, I mean, obviously he had a huge hand, but how light are you calling him in that spot generally? With because that flop obviously hits his range more than your range, et cetera, so that constructs everything. But I was wondering sort of what your calling range is in there.
Well, I called him with a pretty. I made kind of a hero call here, so you might say my range is kind of fucked up here. I called with like an overpair.
Yeah,
and a missed flush draw. The thing is, like, again, this is like the type of spot where, you know, you want to be blocking his value range, so calling with hands that have like sixes and sevens in them is good. Calling with hands that have like a nine in them is good. You know, in general, he's probably check raising. The way he would construct his flop check raising range would be mostly stuff like the nuts, top set, big draws, and some blockers, or some like medium draws. So something like, you know, if he has something like pocket sixes or pocket sevens, like with a little piece of the board, you know, he'll probably take this line.
Would he continue? So this is a definite, if he had just the 6-7 and didn't make a full house in the river, you think he plays the hand very much the same way?
So he kind of took like a blocking size on the river. He didn't go big,
right,
which makes a lot of sense with his range on this board, basically.
Okay.
He can definitely have like pocket 9s and pocket 8s, but he also has a lot of 6-7, which lost some strength this hand. So maybe, like, if I were him, my approach on the river would be something like, I would bet some of my 6-7 on the river. Like, generally, the 6-7 that blocks full houses would be more likely to bet.
Right.
So if I had something
5-6-7?
Yeah, 5-6-7, 3-6-7, 6-7-9, 6-7-8-9, stuff like that. That would be more of a bet. And then the weaker stuff, I probably would do some checking with. And then there's also probably some spots where I'm not sure what to do, and I would kind of flip a coin, basically.
Yeah. All right, one more hand that I found that I want to ask you about.
It's good to know that the best players in the world still randomly flip coins and have no idea what to do in some river spots.
Yeah.
It makes me feel better.
This is another 50-100 hand. This is against Lot Nice again. He's on the button, and he raises again 50-100. And you call. So he raises on the button with ace-queen-jack-3 with the ace-queen of clubs. And you call in the big blind with 9-9-7-4 with spades. Again, he raises, you call. The flop is king-10-8. He flops a rat, the top rat to the nuts, backdoor club draw. You flop an open-ender with your 7-9 to the 10-8. And he, you check, he bets, and you call. Well, the turn gives you the nuts, gives you the six of diamonds. And this is sort of where I wanted to ask you about. It brings a backdoor flush draw. You check. Again, you have the nuts. He bets, and you just call. And given I was looking at this board thinking you're vulnerable to a lot of his range, there's a backdoor flush draw, I was wondering why you would check call in that spot.
Right. So the thing is, in PLO, like you say, I'm vulnerable, but that is in many ways one of the reasons why I check called.
Okay.
Because, okay, so let's say I check raise and he calls. Like, how many rivers can I actually value?
There are almost no, like, there's offsuit deuces, blanks. Offsuit threes, offsuit fours. Yeah,
right.
There's
exactly.
Almost so nothing, like, that leaves you with the nuts on the river. Yeah.
Exactly. I have the nuts on the turn. I'm very unlikely to have the nuts on the river. So that means that with my 7-9s, I'm mostly going to be check-raising my 7-9.
With backup?
With stuff. Yeah. This one probably is an okay one to check, to pot anyway, because I have pocket nines. So I'm blocking a lot of his, like, bigger draws and blocking him from having 7-9 with a bigger redraw.
Right.
And there's another aspect that is basically board coverage. I need to have the nuts on blank rivers after I check all the turns sometimes. I can't never have 7-9 on offsuit 2s, 3s, 4s, 5s. So I want to have... I want to have some 7-9 in my check-raising range, and I want to have some of it in my check-calling range. You know, the breakdown of that is often pretty difficult and not to know exactly when. It's entirely possible this was a mistake
But it makes sense. It makes sense. If you have to check-call with the nuts sometimes, it makes sense to check-call with the nuts without a redraw as opposed to the nuts with a redraw, right?
Right. Yes. In general, if you have the nuts in a redraw, unless you're just, like, blocking everything that he can continue with... Those are types of hands that you want to just pile in all the money with, because you want to take your equity, basically.
You played the fifth largest hand of the year. Do you remember this hand? As tracked by High Stakes Database, this is a hand where you're playing True Teller, mm-hmm. and you guys are playing pretty deep. You each have 100K, and I think you're in the button, and you raise with the King 10 of Hearts. And two sixes. You're playing 200, 400. You raise to 1350. True Teller, three bets to 4240. And you call. The flop comes Jack 8-6 with two clubs. You flop bottom set with two sixes, the King 10 of Hearts. He leads. You raise, and you guys get in 100,000 each on the flop. And I was looking at that hand going, wow. I mean, you're getting 100K in. What's that?
That's approximately one Vancouver mortgage.
It's a Vancouver mortgage.
A month.
it's 250 big blinds in on the flop, basically, with bottom set on a pretty wet board. I was curious about that hand, given that you don't have much backup. You have the King 10 of Hearts, so you got runner straight draws. But
you can see he doesn't have a whole lot either.
Yeah, True Teller has the ace king 10-4. He 3-bet. He has the ace 4 clubs, so he flops in that flush draw and seems to be happy to get it in there. Are you just always going to get 250 big blinds in there with bottom set, no redraw? Is that specific
or
to
what
opponent?
Happened here?
Well,
yeah.
And he's 3-bet, so he's pretty unlikely to have pocket jacks or pocket eights. He definitely has some pocket jacks and pocket eights in his range, not like a ton. Definitely at this stack depth, getting in bottom set is, like, fine.
Yeah.
It's a 3-bet pot, so, you know, there's, like, 9K in the, or 8,500 in the flop, and, you know, we have, like, 10x pot to play. So it's, like, certainly a strong enough hand to get in. There's definitely some sets I would call with on the flop. I'm not certain if this is, like, one that maybe I should just call with. It's a very vulnerable hand, obviously, but it's certainly strong enough to get it in with on the flop.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think my play is, like, more or less standard.
when you win a pot like that, is there a fist pump? Are you closing your...
I was pretty excited about that. I try to be like ice cold whenever I can be, and like, yeah, you know, I think it's like the better approach, but you know, sometimes you can't help yourself.
I guess not. Yeah. That's a pretty big one.
They did run it twice, so there's that about it.
Oh yeah, true enough. Yeah, so yeah.
We ran it twice, yeah.
All right, so we've got a bunch of stuff to talk to. We're going to have Donnie sit in on the In Case You Missed It segment too. So let's get to that in a bit, or after the break here. Roscoe, do you want to talk a little bit about PLOQuickPro.com?
Sure do. Visit PLOQuickPro.com. It is the number one training site for PLO players. It is the only site that has an entire suite of PLO courses designed by WSOP bracelet winner John Beaupre and 2015 5K PLO scoop winner Alien Slayer. Over the past few years, they've successfully taught more than 1,000 players how to master the fundamentals, increase their win rate, and move up in stakes for good. So whether you're a smaller micro-stakes grinder trying to become a winner for the first time, you're already a winning player and you're trying to make more money and move up in stakes, and especially if you're a no-limit player and you're trying to make the transition to PLO, they've got videos, PDFs, and tutorials to help you plug leagues and look at the game in a new way. So if you'd like to learn the guaranteed fastest way to master the fundamentals, increase your win rate, and move up in stakes for good, visit PLOQuickPro.com/pokercast to get your very own personalized PLO curriculum. You can also reach out to John personally at john@PLOQuickPro.com.
Awesome. Coming up after the break, we're going to do some In Case You Missed It, some other stuff. And then in the third segment, we'll do some emails, some Ross Report. You're listening to the 2 Plus 2 PokerCast. Keep it right here.
Hey, poker fans. Don't forget about the 2plus2.com digital magazine. Each month, a wide array of poker professionals and media write fascinating articles about the game you love. Want to learn about big blind versus small blind hand ranges? How about optimal Jeopardy daily double strategy? Topics like those and many others are covered every month. Head on over to 2plus2.com to see what the magazine has to offer this month. Attention everyone not named Alan Kessler. Have someone you would love to appear on the PokerCast? Have someone you don't want to hear again on the PokerCast? Head on over to the Suggest a Guest thread in the PokerCast forum at 2plus2.com, and Adam will do his best to make you happy. P.S. Chainsaw, you can post too. I want to please my papers, don't let me live.
Welcome back to the 2 Plus 2 PokerCast. We are sitting here with Mr. Dani Stern, Terrence Chan, and Roscoe. Why don't we get into
nice to be on your show again.
And Alan Kessler. Why don't we get into... well, first of all, you had a funny story about the R420 show.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So, as listeners of the show will remember, last week was PokerCast 420, and we made all the required...
I tried
marijuana
to get high.
Puns. Well, yeah. Okay. So, of course, we're going to make the required marijuana puns, being from Vancouverites, born and raised.
Yeah. Hear it every day.
And so, yeah, you actually, out of nowhere, recapping real quick for those who didn't catch the show last week, Adam just hits up me and Ross on Skype and says, like, so how do I just buy weed at these, like, you know, Donnie, yeah, you've been around, you walk by, there's the a million dispensaries, you just, you know, but
can you walk into
thank
one?
Thank you. Exactly, yeah, exactly.
How hard is it?
You know, but they're I understand, because they're kind of, like, intimidating, they've all got, like, the curtains
over the
dark
not really looking
room.
To get high very often,
yeah,
so I don't really know what's happening.
Exactly, so you didn't know what was going on, and so, as I understand it, and I don't know a lot about this stuff either, you need a prescription. You need a prescription of basically any kind.
Anything.
And some photo ID that says you're over 19, which is the legal age here.
Dude!
Cigarettes. Right. So the prescription can be for anything, like, you know, antibiotics. It could be cold. It's just a prescription from a doctor.
And I haven't been to the doctor in years. I have zero prescriptions. I don't have, like, high blood pressure. I want to say it's been 5 years since I've had a prescription.
Right.
For
so I'm
so
like,
I
thinking,
couldn't do it.
I'm thinking, yeah, like that's not really possible. Like it's, you know, weed in Vancouver has always been this situation before it was legal where it was like, you know, everybody just knows a guy.
Yeah.
You know, the kind of thing. But now the dispensaries are, you know, they're everywhere, and I think that's kind of squeezed that market out. So, you know, you ended up making a valiant effort, but we can figure out how it goes. Fast forward to maybe 2 days later, there's a dispensary, like, I mean, 100 steps from where we're standing right now. And I just kind
of... There's one 100 steps from pretty much anywhere you stand in Vancouver.
Right. So, I'm not giving away my home location. Exactly. So I walk out on the street, I'm just like, you know what? How hard is it? I'm just.
You wanted to find out.
I wanted to find out, and I literally have no idea on me. Nothing on me right now. I have my phone.
That's okay? All you had.
And so I have my phone. I walk in there, and the girls did that. You know, I actually have to. You have to ring a buzzer and look into a camera. It's like the opening scene from.
Can't just walk in.
Yeah, like so. Teddy KGB like opens the latch on the other side. No, so yeah, you have to actually buzz and look at the camera, and then the girl comes and she lets me in. She says like. She is stoned out of her mind. By the way. She's not like this girl is. This
she's,
girl is
she's
not
using
like,
the product.
Yeah, is very unprofessional. She's like just. I'm just
high on your own supply.
Yeah, and I'm just can't like, well, I have to ask something now, and I'm like, I need something that like will help me sleep or something. I'm just like, well,
yeah,
that seems like a standard.
Yeah, I got a sore trigger. Shoulder.
And she's like, okay, well, we've got this and X and Y and Z and all the other things. And, you
that's
know,
probably like, a weird question for them, too. They're probably just, like, used to being like, I need something that gets me really high.
Really high. Really, I just want to get fucked up really
let's
bad.
Let's get right to the point.
And then, you know, and she's like, okay, we've got this. And I'm like, oh, okay, like, how much is that? And she's like, whatever. And I'm like, okay, so how do I get some? Like, what do I need? And she's like, do you have a card? And I'm like, no, I don't have a card. She's like, well, do you have a membership with someone? I'm like, no, not really. And she's like, So I'm like, well, I have my ID on me. And then I look and I have this, you know, you guys can see it, but it's basically my phone has like this little pouch in the back where I keep like my credit cards. And so I'm like, well, all I actually have is my ID. But what I actually have, I look and I have my Hong Kong driver's license. And in Hong Kong, there's no pictures on this. So this is in no way going to qualify as ID. Right. And then before I can even explain this, she's like, oh, well, you're clearly not like 17 or whatever. So like, I'll just give it to you.
Wow. So there's no.
So I have no idea. I have no prescription. I have no idea. She's not even gonna ID for me for age, which by the way makes me feel terrible. I don't like I don't, know. I don't. Like,
you're clearly not 17.
I'm clearly not 17.
You're
so,
clearly not 17. Buddy.
So clearly,
I hate to break it to you.
Yeah, I know. By the way, I told you guys this on the break. Lon McCarron just tweeted that he got ID'd at a bar or something,
which is hilarious. That's I mean, Lon's he's our guy. He's an older dude.
He's not 20.
He's definitely not 17.
So the moral of the story is, if you had wanted to get fucked up last week, all you had to do was walk in.
I could have done it.
I don't think she would have thought you were 17.
No,
either.
I don't think I'm going to pass for that.
So, yeah, the regulations, not as tough as I thought.
Okay, well, we'll do it 1 week. I'll try it 1 week. Have you guys been following the Olympics? Do you watch any Olympics? Are you interested
course,
in anything?
Yeah, I watch them.
Donnie, you watch
some highlights. Not.
Phelps, have you going to watch?
Speaking of marijuana.
Yeah, speaking of marijuana, the marijuana has really held Michael Phelps back, hasn't it? He goes out and wins 6 more medals. The last I saw, anyway, 4 gold.
Yeah,
was it 5 more medals, 4 gold, and a silver?
You can't accomplish anything if you smoke marijuana.
Impressive. I was looking for some of the poker boys in the front row to see if maybe they travel down there with them.
Yeah, well, Locke is supposed to be there, right? I think Locke went down there.
Oh yeah,
I read that Locke is definitely down there. He and Phelps are boys. So, but you didn't catch any highlights on TV.
No, I didn't.
Somehow Helmuth managed not to get himself on TV at a major sporting event
during the Olympics.
Yeah,
is he there?
Well, I don't know, but
I know he's always like courtside.
Yeah, like he's if there's a camera somewhere, he should be in front of it, right? So,
yeah.
All right, let's get into some in case you missed it.
How did he miss the open goal? 6-4, and he comes up 0. Oh no! Oh yes, he missed it.
He's missed it. How on earth did he miss that?
In case you missed it, David Baazov has resigned from all positions with Amaya Gaming. Of course, he was facing insider trading charges, I believe, in March. He's defending himself from them, claims he's innocent. He didn't do any of the things that he's alleged to have done, but he has resigned. And, you know, obviously we're not going to know why, the politics of what's going on there. But, I mean, I think a safe assumption is there's, you know, a concerted effort now by PokerStars to get into California, all kinds of other states. If opponents can kind of hold up this president of the company, that look, this guy's a scam artist. He's up for an insider trading charges. That's probably has something to do with it, I would think. He keeps his I believe it's 17% ownership in Amaya. So it's not like he's, you know, on the outside, but What a story this guy is. Someday there'll be a book or a movie written about this guy. He, you know, the story about him sleeping in a hockey rink in Montreal, being homeless, to being the CEO of a $5 billion company or whatever it was, getting 17% or whatever, 17, 20% of the company by, you know, of Amaya, but not owning or not putting up any of the money. Meanwhile, he buys a $5 billion company, Pokerstars. And the course that Pokerstars, of course, took after he took it over. So many amazing, interesting aspects to the story. But now that he's resigned, I wonder if we've seen a large shift. Donnie, we've talked about this already, of course, the shift in Pokerstars' tact on how they approach the market. I wonder if without Baazov at the helm, it's going to be the same road.
I wouldn't expect any changes with Baazov gone. My impression of the changes and what happened at the company, it's not like he was leading the charge and everyone was just following him. This was like a decision made company-wide, and I think, I wouldn't expect all of a sudden Baazov is gone and they're just like, that's it, no more rake, it's all free.
Let's go back to East Side.
Supernova Elite for everyone. No, I don't think that's happening. You know, I think they're just a publicly traded company now, and they got him, you know. Gotta
maximize revenue at any cost.
Exactly.
You went over to the meetings, of course, was it last year?
It was January this year.
How high up do you, when you go over those meetings, how high up do you get to meet with guys? Is it sort of the poker team? Is it guys from the upper board?
I mean, Baazov was there.
Baazov was there?
Yeah. He was there for part of it. And then some other guys from Amaya and from PokerStar, from Rational Group were there as well.
Did he seem like receptive to the things that the poker pros were saying? Like, did he, like, what's your sort of impression? I mean, I assume you talked. I mean, I imagine the topic du jour was obviously the Supernova Elite stuff. What was his reaction? What was your impression?
I think he thought the animals were running the farm.
Hmm.
I think he did not really give two craps about what we had to say. Okay. I mean, he was outwardly receptive and said, you know, thanks for coming and all that. But I don't think the content of what we were saying really resonated with him,
okay,
is what I should say.
Yeah.
Was there anybody else that you felt it might have resonated with, or was it just a big, you know, across the board?
I mean, it was a mix. I think some of the guys there, I think some of them did feel, like, personally, like, upset that their reputation in the poker community had been harmed, and I think probably some people didn't really care.
There was a moment you were talking about, which I thought was interesting, when you said along the lines of you didn't feel your money was as safe as it once was at Stars.
Well, I don't think that they're going to pull a UB or full tilt or anything like
right.
that. But, you know, I mean, things like cash out fees or conversion fees or something, I think are like kind of in the realm of possibility now. I mean, conversion fees already already exist. And things like that I think in the past PokerStars never really would have done. I think under, like, the Scheinbergs, you know, anything that would sort of just, like, take money from players' accounts, basically, and interfere with just the general flow of the games, I don't think that was, like, something they ever considered. Now, obviously, adding a million or 2 million to the books every quarter, making the board happy is something that they're more interested in now. I think there's, like, a lot of things that they can do that are kind of, like, on their end, there are, like, nickel and diming, you know, but on the player's end are, like, that's
big deal.
Yeah. You know, and for them, it's important to make up that extra, like, couple million revenue every quarter or whatever, you know?
Make the interest payments. Yeah. The financials were released, from this quarter just passed. Revenue from internet poker, was $216 million for the first 3 months of 2016. Down 11% from $242 million during the same period year over year. But revenue was the same because they had growth in sportsbook and casino. This really drives home the thought that everybody seems to have, that the direction of PokerStars has shifted. We're going towards mining the database for what it could be worth, and, you know, exposing them to a lot of products that are negative EV, let's say, and... service, you know, there's always, everybody said, well, they buy a $5 billion company, you got to service the debt, etc. Just kind of that 11% year-over-year decline for poker revenue seemed to be pretty stark, given that they had savings in the VIP program and other things like that. I don't know if it's net,
well,
but...
Well, and given that, I mean, there's a bit of a small recovery in poker. This, you know, it seems like a little while. Like, the World Series was fairly robust this
right.
year. I mean, poker seemed, you know, the reports of poker's immediate death seemed somewhat exaggerated. So we're talking about this in the larger context of, okay, 11% year over year, like, we could have understood this, if not for the fact that poker itself actually didn't have a terrible year. So it definitely shows the emphasis, the de-emphasizing of poker as a product within Amaya, or at least that's how people like you and I are interpreting it, right?
Yeah, and I don't know revenue-wise for them exactly on their books how it's counted in terms of, like, last year when they had obviously a huge percentage of their revenue had to go back to the VIP payments.
Right.
I don't know exactly how they counted that on
the books. That's an editing, yeah.
I'm not entirely sure. But...
Yeah, I mean, getting back to Baazov real quick, a guy who owns 20% of a $5 billion company or whatever it's worth to...
Way less now.
It's like, yeah.
Market cap's like $2.5 billion.
Is it $2.5 billion?
Something like that now? I'm not sure.
I mean, I guess I'm looking at the time of when he was at the beginning. Remember, the insider trading charges came from when they acquired PokerStars. So they were in the process, or he was in the process of getting this...
$3 billion. $3.05 billion.
This big wealth accumulation, but... if the allegations are true, that wasn't enough for him, that he needed to be able to, you know, inside trading and trade on the knowledge that he had that other people didn't. It's just surprising to me where a guy's on the precipice of buying a company like PokerStars would do something like that.
Right. I don't think any of us know the actual, like, true details of what really went down. But it did seem like, from what I read from when the thing was released, like, the amount of money was...
True.
It was very small,
to,
right? It
yeah.
wasn't like they're alleging that he made off with some huge sum.
Right.
So it did, and combined, there were like 16 people named in the indictment that were involved or something,
brother,
right?
So it
seemed odd, I would say. It just seemed like a strange amount of money for, like you said, given the stakes of everything that was happening. It seems strange. I'm very curious to see where it goes.
Yeah.
I don't know. What happened?
We will find out, I guess. In case you missed it, Bovada, the U.S. facing poker room, is migrating its poker platform to a skin called Ignition Poker. So basically all the... Remember, Bovada is a big entertainment and sports betting company. Casino, they're moving their poker away from them. The casino sportsbook players, they're moving it over to Ignition to isolate it, so it would seem. And you can only wonder if it has to do with the fact that, you know, poker players are now looked at upon as a drag and poker or, you know, gaming sites revenue. We're going to move them away from because the sportsbook players are going to jump in the poker game, lose their money. Meanwhile, the sportsbook doesn't get it back. That would seem to be the impetus for this.
Yeah, I would assume that they figure the ROI of the money that's in the sports bettors. Like, if they have a sports betting whale and, you know, he has $10,000 in his sports betting account, their ROI on that is much higher than if he has $10,000 in his poker account.
Yeah.
And that they prefer to keep him betting sports. Obviously the counter argument would be, but a lot of these guys, they want both. That's the product that they come for is not just the sports betting. They like being able to play some poker and play casino games or whatever they have on
the site.
This
was sort
of
the thought when, you know, back when Las Vegas poker rooms lost money, right, when they were considered a nuisance, was that, well, at least they get people in here, they get stuck in the poker game, and they blast off in black in table games and in sports book and stuff like that. So the extent to which the online experience has that, I mean, I think that makes sense because putting money in one site and taking it out and putting it in on another is kind of a pain in the ass, right?
Especially in the United States.
Yeah, exactly. Especially in the United States, which is, you know, what we're talking about with Bovada. So, you know, if you have these poker players taking their money off of Bovada, maybe they won't dump it into the sports book. But we'll
which
see.
Makes me think with PokerStars moving to a more sports book, casino aspect of the company now. The shift changes from poker being less and less of their volume? Is there some point where A, the games get better because they're bringing in sports bettors to play in the poker games, and then B, doing the same thing that Bovada is doing and shifting them off somewhere else?
But you know, I mean, in terms of like identity of what they want themselves to be, I mean, if you want to be a one stop shop for all your internet gambling needs, you know, poker, sports, casino, race, whatever, you would think they want all of it to be integrated and to be as smooth of a thing as possible. I mean, the thing is, for Bovada, one of the reasons that they're able to do this is that they have kind of a monopoly on the U.S. gambling market because,
right.
I mean, what else is there? There's like ACR and Carb. I don't mess with any of these sites. And so I don't even know, like, you know, what if somebody really wants to bet sports, my understanding is basically like you got Bovada and
that's it.
So I'm sure there's some sites that are even shadier.
Yeah.
or you can go to your local bookie or whatever. And
well, I think that's their primary competition, yeah, really. If you want to talk about it, just yeah. actual offline sports betting.
Yeah. Maybe Run It Once should hire a sports betting coach.
That'd be good.
Are you applying for the job? Is that what you're trying?
Yeah, I'll get in there.
Just quickly before we move off Bodog, I wanted to get your opinion on their anonymous tables at the poker.
Yeah, I mean, I have like played on Bovada, and I think it works. Like, it's interesting. I mean, I would be very, very concerned at high stakes there, though, that there would be cheating going on. It seems like
right.
it would be so much easier on there than on other sites.
You sit down, your friend sits down.
Well, yeah, exactly.
You, obviously, two people sit down. It's very easy to be on the same table when you're in playing super high stakes.
You would never know.
Share cards and
yeah,
PLO, it's a big deal.
I mean, like one of the reasons that, like, I think at high stakes, it's probably on Stars, it's pretty hard to get away with this stuff, is that all the, like, everybody's so well known who plays. Like, there's such a small player pool. If a new person pops up, if all of a sudden two new people pop up and are always at the same table, like, it would take like three sessions before everybody was like, okay, there's something up here.
Really? It would have to be a new account conspiring with an existing
right, exactly.
account.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And even then, it would take only some amount before people were like, these two guys are always playing together, you know.
Right. And Stars, you know, to give them credit, you know, because we talk a lot of shit about them, could be quite frank about it, is very good at the game security stuff. I mean, I know this, I've seen this behind the scenes, and they know what they're doing in this regard. They're by far the most experienced people in the game security, and they would, especially with the assistance of the players, be able to pick up on that stuff really
right.
quickly.
Right. And at Bovada,
we don't know what's going on.
Who knows what's going on behind the scenes? Yeah.
Right.
Who knows like, what they think about this, or do they care? I think they probably care about it only to the point where it might end up hurting their bottom line.
Right.
And that point might not exist because it's all anonymous and people just don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's a very interesting concept, and I don't like dismiss it outright, but it also has a whole slew of problems.
All right, let's move on. In case you missed it, Party Poker held a $2,600 high roller tournament with a 100K guarantee, and it ran into a bit of trouble. The three players regged at the start. So again, everybody late regs for a lot of these tournaments.
Mm-hmm.
Three player regged at the start. Again, 100K guarantee, $2,600 to buy in, and the guys either conspired together, they're Russian players, or they realized pretty quickly that their EV of going all in right away was pretty high, given that the first place player is going to get, you know, his portion of the 100K.
50K or something.
Yeah. So what happens is they go all in every hand, one guy wins, they get all their accounts shut down. First of all, let's talk about the ethics of this, because this is, again, a tournament that's being offered by a website. It's not the players, you know, holding some. I mean, these players are just registering into a tournament, and whether they conspire, let's say they don't conspire, and you realize quickly that your EV of shoving and getting the tournament over really quickly is pretty high, and you're going to fire away and get it in. I mean, is that ethical to begin with?
I think if it's explicit collusion, it's definitely unethical, because.
So where's the line? Talking to each other?
I think it might be.
Yeah.
I think it is. I mean, look, like,
if you want to take the word, so let's say you know, the other two guys are really stupid. And so you just decide to go all in every hand. You know you're going to be getting it in bad, right? Because you're going to go all in, and they're going to like fold a few times.
And then
they're going to pick up like ace jack and call because you're just spazzing with, 500 big blinds, and they figure you're
and you have
favorite.
The queen 10.
Yeah, exactly. And you get it in bad, but you're one close player to close to eliminating. You just keep shoving blind. The other guy realizes he might actually figure out what's going on at this point. Like, oh, wait, I see what this guy's doing. And so if you don't communicate it, I'm right there with Donnie. It's like, if you don't communicate this explicitly, it's clearly fine to just move it all in every hand and realize and just hope that you manage to bust the other two guys before the tournament, before people register in the tournament.
The tournament gets canceled by Party Poker and rescheduled for 90 minutes later. None of the three play that had originally played. Now, it's not clear if their accounts were frozen, given that they'd, won money. But... now, is it ethical on the Party Poker's side to cancel this tournament and freeze everybody's
under what situation? Given that they discussed it, or
given that they did not discuss it, because
if they didn't discuss it,
they Party Poker has no proof they discussed. They're not going to, talk in the chat, and clearly they're
right.
So if they're talking, it's
well,
offline.
I mean, I'm not sure that they don't. There's no way to obtain proof. Like, let's say the first four or five hands play out normally, just like the way they normally would. And then all of a sudden on the sixth hand, they just all go all in with garbage. It's kind of clear at that point.
That's true.
One of them reached out to the other two or, said something.
Right.
And again, this is the kind of stuff that game security departments exist for, and to look over those hand histories.
But you could also argue that they realized at that point that their EV of shoving was higher. I mean,
this is, this has happened on Stars before and Satellites. And I think a lot of players are dismissive of the idea that there's anything wrong with this. They're like, well, of course it's not. Who does it hurt? It's only the sites who made the guarantee. And
the guarantee's there for you guys too.
It's not like stealing $10 from a random person is that different from stealing $10 from a bank? Obviously the bank can take it and the other guy can't as much or whatever, but you still can't just steal $10 from a bank or whatever. First of all, let's be realistic here. You do this a few times, the site's going to catch on. What's going to happen? They're going to lower their guarantees, which hurts the players.
Right.
Okay? It's naive to think that people can just get away with this and it's just fine. The sites are going to either lower their guarantees, they're going to cancel the tournament, you're going to get in trouble in some way.
Well, they could also just have not late registration. Oh, are we talking? I'm a bit lost. Are we still talking about the situation where they've discussed this offline, or are we talking about the situation where they, like I hypothesized before, where I as an independent entity just shove all in every hand, and then you realize, oh wait, this is what Terrence is doing, and then Adam realizes, oh, this is what these guys are doing.
I'm talking about people explicitly discussing.
Okay, then I agree with you.
My understanding is that this has happened in Stars Satellites, where there's been six or seven people registered,
right,
and it was a 20-person guarantee or something, mm-hmm, and they all agreed to do it.
That's clearly...
Yeah. And I said, I think the outcome of practicing this behavior is just an obvious down, net negative for everyone. It is the site's fault for not having some protection involved in this. First of all, here's how Party could just avoid this, is that as long as registration is still open, the tournament is not over. So the guy...
He just sits there by himself.
He just sits there by himself with three starting stats, and then people can still register.
Right.
Okay, then there's no harm done, that would be one thing to do. Another would be
have a 10-player minimum or something like
that. Yeah, have the tournament not fire until there's two tables or something that.
These are software solutions that clearly they don't have, because obviously these are software solutions that have to be implemented. Somebody has to write the
code. Has to be done beforehand.
Yeah, obviously. It has to be done.
We're okay with Party canceling the tournament and taking the money back.
It's really weird because it does seem like it's pretty clear that they discussed it and then decided.
Is it? I don't know what actually happened.
Well, the guy, a button shoves, small blind, heck, queens.
Is it the literal first hand?
I don't know what hand it is. It's very, very quick, very, very early.
Okay.
But button shoves, queens in the small blind calls, king three off in the big blind calls. But you could argue that king three off in the big blind is getting a price.
First of all, king three off calling there is clearly correct.
Yeah, that's what... Yeah.
He knows the situation. Once the other two people are all in, he knows
I can win
if I just fade this 15% or whatever.
Yeah, I guess, 12%,
then I get
If there's no discussion, I mean,
if that's the actual hand history, that's entirely
that's
possible that it was that nobody had any discussion.
They just realized what was
going
on.
Because the first guy is just like, maybe
these
guys
are smart. They're playing a $2,600 tournament. Yeah. They're not idiots.
So the first guy is like, maybe they'll figure it out. I'm just going to go all in with, what did he have, the first guy?
I don't know.
Some garbage.
Two rags.
So he goes with some garbage. The second guy has no idea what's going on. He's just like, I pocket
queens.
And then the third guy figures it out because it's not that hard to figure out.
It's like, okay, maybe I'm getting in bad, but whatever.
There's a 100
massive overlay.
So in that situation, I don't know.
It's
weird.
True. If that's all the information and they're like, you said they were all from Russia. I mean, there's a lot of interesting things that would going on too. Like, Russia's a big place. Are these IPs all coming from the same city block? Like, were there friends? Is there enough time for them to have potentially discussed this on
Skype? I just feel like it's so hard to prove
There's a lot of information that Party should have that we don't have.
And like, if I'm playing like a random tournament on a Sunday like that in that situation, it's a good chance. I have a bunch of tables up. It's the first hand. It pops up. What the hell are these idiots doing? Like, I'm not paying attention, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't realize that we're in this crazy shit. How do I know it's like the only tip? Maybe there's like three other tables that I didn't realize what was going on.
Yeah. This is a situation where, it would be really good to know what the internal party emails look like because they know so much more. Like, are these guys snap making these decisions? Or was there like the 20-second lag before the first guy opened or something like that that we could decide? Like, there should be a lot of information. So absent that information, it's really hard to make.
Yeah, I'm sure they can do some sort of audit for that. Think so. I mean, I'm sure Stars
can. Party's been around for, 20 years, like, or something? They should have that.
So there's circumstances then where you're fine with Party Poker saying, okay, they would have to have complete proof, or...
I think they would have to have excellent, very strong proof, yeah.
Otherwise,
to
they
take
should,
that money
people
they,
should,
they,
have
they
the
should
money.
Honor their guarantee. Yeah.
And just change their approach.
Yeah, honor their guarantee, but don't have this stupid exploitability in your software and in your tournament scheduling. You know, figure out a better way to do this.
You need offshore to figure out who we, gambling websites.
Send a bill for consultation to Party Poker for their tournament consultation.
That's right.
Yeah, I'm not a product or a programmer guy, but, you know.
In case you missed it, the World Championship of Online Poker in September every year, of course. The schedule was announced. We're going to have Brian, PokerStars Brian, on next week to talk about it, so we're not going to get too in-depth.
Still allowed on here?
Still, yeah. Absolutely. Brian's a tournament witch. We're happy to have him on talk
it's
about
the authority.
The World Championship.
It's like going out for dinner with your ex-girlfriend.
Is that when it kicks back in, Donnie? The World Championship, you know, August, the summer, he's traveling.
It's kind of, we're in the off season. We're back at WCube is like opening day. It's like the season restarts.
Yeah.
Definitely. I mean, like for all like the complaining I do about like online PLO kind of like fizzling a little and action being slow and all that, like every year without fail, WCube and Scoop, it is packed and people are playing and it's awesome.
Like, all the old guys that used to play come back and...
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of guys who are like...
Guys like that.
The most you can bet or raise is the size of a pup.
I love that.
I mean, the thing is, like... No, like, Ike is around all the time,
is
usually.
He?
But guys like... there's, like, guys like Americans who, you know, they spend 4 or 5 months a year outside the U.S. to play online, you know. And so if they're going to pick, like, two of the month, they're always going to be out, you know, in September... And in May, they're always going to be in Europe or in Canada or Mexico to play. And I'm talking about like professional poker players, but still, just like having that many people online, it gets the action going. Like when there's like a 20 person Zoom pool, all sorts of people start coming out of the woodwork to play 25, 50 PLO.
It's
like,
an inertia thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Girls and girls.
You know who that is?
Wait, what was it?
Boys and girls.
Oh, Hudson. But that's not even him, right? That's the impression.
That's from
of him.
The Jedi Master
yeah,
video.
Jedi, I knew it. Yeah, that's all time great.
But it's the strongest argument in favor of MTTs. We talked a second ago when we were talking about the Bovada stuff. You know, does the sports book draw people in? Do the casino games draw people in? This, what you're saying, is a perfectly clear example of having an MTT series. And that actually builds the cash games around it. I mean, we see it in live poker, and we know that as well that it translates to online poker, where you would think it wouldn't necessarily, because what's the barrier to entry to online poker? Oh, I have to turn on the computer. Like, that's the literal
barrier. Or I have
barrier.
To travel to Canada
yeah,
or Mexico.
Yeah, but there is, for the American
Yeah, but it's
pros,
like, everybody's
this.
Like, I'm going there because there's going to be a bunch of action.
Yeah. Right.
And then, so there's a bunch of action. Like,
right.
It's, you know, self-fulfilling prophecy.
Exactly.
But also, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, you guys might know better than I, but as an online poker historian, one of the things that really propelled Stars to the front back in the day was they were the first site to have like really big tournaments, right?
Yes.
And I think a lot of the other sites, if I remember correctly, were kind of hesitant about tournaments because you think about the type of payouts that it creates,
right?
Where everybody puts in a little bit of money and then one guy gets a ton. He's just going to cash it out.
Yep. Pokerstars.
So everybody's worried about that. And Pokerstars are like, no, just have big tournaments. It'll get people on the site.
Exactly.
And then you have like the Sunday Million and things like that way back in the day. It was a huge marketing thing.
Yeah,
for the
exactly.
Site.
I mean, Paradise and Party, who were the market leaders at the time, basically just had sit and goes, right? They had 10 player tournaments, and Party flirted a little while with the MTTs, but then Stars really started to do the MTTs, and of course that's where they got the idea to run, oh, let's do satellites to the main event and figure this out. Mm-hmm. And we all know where that went.
Yeah, and satellites to the main event, that's another, like, it's obviously like going to be a net loss to your poker, your little poker economy, because you're taking $10,000.
Yep.
And it's getting cashed out.
Well, the one year they qualified like 600 people or something like that.
Right.
That's a ton of money.
Yeah, back in the day that was,
system. But you're selling the dream, right? You know, you're selling the dream, and you're creating action on the site.
Yeah, and I think a lot of us seem to be afraid that Stars is no longer concerned with selling the dream. It's just the allure of winning a bunch of money.
They're concerned with selling the gamble, the sort of the idea with spin and goes.
Yes.
And, you know, they're selling the gamble more than the dream.
Yeah, but...
Then they hold a great event, Scoop, World
Absolutely.
Championship Online.
Oh, no, yeah.
Poker.
I mean,
these are the, you know, great events that they have every year.
No, and I have a million criticisms of Stars, especially recently. But there's no denying, like, they put on some incredibly great poker events.
Both live and
online. The EPT is, like, in my opinion, like, the gold standard of what live tournaments should be.
For sure.
Like, I love going to Vegas every summer for the World Series, but in terms of like the actual company and the World Series brand, I think they do like they don't do anywhere near as good a job as they could. I think the EPT does like a much better job, and I think like for the amount of poker you get in like a 10-day series in an EPT is incredible. Mm-hmm. Like it provides so much. Like they understand that like for the traveling pro, you know, you can't just go and show up and play like a 2500 and spend $400 a night in a hotel. Like it just doesn't work. You know, they just pack so much stuff in, and they do a good job. And W Coop and Scoop are always like huge hits. So I just wish they wouldn't have so many hyper turbos and rake them like they're
rake them
regular
going
tournaments.
Crazy.
Yeah.
The PCA, it's final year this year in January. You heading down to the very last and final PCA?
Is it? I missed that one.
I don't know. I didn't hear
totally
that. What's
that?
The last one.
Yeah. Well,
are they moving?
Breaking
it? Are they moving
here.
It? Yeah, Jesus.
I don't think I'm breaking this story.
I feel like
pretty
me
sure
and Donnie are knowing stuff about that. Okay, tell us what's going on. What's going on?
I don't know why.
They have to have a January tournament. Like, that's just like a... Like, there has to be a tournament. You know, the World Series has to be in the summer. There has to be, like, a beginning of January
Google
tournament.
PCA 2017.
Final PCA. Let's Google in real time here.
I know that their contract was up last year
or
this year.
Well, it's such a terrible
something.
Venue, right? I mean, we talk about it every year. Like, what the heck?
It's kind of as terrible. Like,
2017
will
be the final year for the PokerStars PCA. From a reliable source, PCA will have the PCA in the Bahamas again in 2017, but that'll be his final year. This is from Poker Fraud Alert, Dandruff, obviously.
Right.
Top Hotel's the site.
Yeah, it is unclear at the site time if the PCA will be replaced by any other tournament or venue. Well, that's a rumor I guess we'll have to ask Brian about.
Yeah, we'll ask Brian next week about that. But.
I mean, I almost always go to PCA. I've probably gone to like 7 of them or something at this point.
Yeah.
And it's a good example. Like, yeah, it's like not the great. I don't like the Atlantis really, but you know, they put on an incredibly good
series
of tournaments. Like, there is like 3 playable tournaments a day for somebody who wants to like play like relatively high stakes. It's unbelievable. How much action there is, and people
they even
show
do things
and,
like experiment with weird funky games
yeah,
too,
they
which
make it
I
fun
really
for
like.
Everybody yeah.
Yeah. I mean, my main complaint with all like their live tournaments and stuff, I just think like some of the turbos and some of the weird events, their rake is just obnoxiously high, but whatever, that's another conversation.
The menu is zeros.
All right, coming up after the break, we're gonna have our favorite segment, the mailbag, and the Roscoe Report. Everybody loves the Roscoe Report.
I think they love mail more.
Yeah. Donnie, you're not going to want to sit in on that. You got to go home, I know.
Well, thanks for having me.
All right, we'll talk to you after the break.
What's up, guys? My name is John Beaupre, and I'm the founder and lead instructor of PLOQuickPro.com. Now, we're the only site that has an entire suite of PLO courses designed by myself, a WSOP champion, and 3-time Supernova Elite PLO Crusher Alien Slayer. Over the past few years, we've successfully taught more than 1,000 players how to master the fundamentals, increase their win rate, and move up in stakes for good. So whether you're a small or micro stakes grinder trying to become a winner for the first time, or you're already a winning player looking to make more money and move up in stakes, and especially if you're a no-limit player looking to make the transition to PLO, we've got the videos, PDFs, and tutorials to help you plug leaks and look at the game in a new way. To learn the guaranteed fastest ways to master the fundamentals, increase your win rate, and move up in stakes for good, visit www.plquickpro.com/pokercast to get your very own personalized PLO curriculum. Or even better, if you'd like to reach out to me personally, shoot me an email at john@plquickpro.com and I'll help you find the best courses to fit your game. Good luck.
Hey, it's Mike from the 2+2 store and professionalpoker.com. 2+2 is pleased to announce the release of their most anticipated book in ages, Applications of No Limit Hold'em, A Guide to Understanding Theoretical Sound Poker by Matthew Janda. This book will give you the ability to create the bet sizings and ranges which will beat the better players. The theory in this book is not designed to be complex or abstract, but rather it's intended to be applied immediately, producing better overall results. Many confusing concepts such as overbetting, balancing multiple bet sizing ranges, donk betting, and check raising as a pre-flop raiser are crucial to a player strategy, despite few players implementing them or talking about them. And after reading this book, you should be able to not only conceptually understand these ideas, but also know how to begin incorporating them into your game and thereby successfully compete against tough opponents. And at the 2+2 store, we accept all credit cards, plus PayPal and NetTeller.
Okay, people, most of the kittens have perished. There are a few left you can save, though, and here's how to do it. Get involved with the PokerCast by emailing your questions, suggestions for the show, or even record a sound clip. Adam will be using the best ones on the air. Well, let's face it, probably the worst ones as well. I can see you there at your computer. Send an email right now. Totally disagree with one of Adam's takes last week? Send an email. Love last week's interview? Email. Want to know how much cash Adam has on him right now? Email. Pokercast@2plus2.com is the address. Ship the funny to Adam today.
Back to the 2+2 Poker Cast. T, I asked you for a little playlist, an MMA playlist.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for sending it to me. I've been it's hard to find some of the fights.
Yeah.
I didn't want to buy the pass or anything.
Well, you don't have to pay for it. You can go to UFC Fight Pass. Yeah. They give you the free month. You just cancel it immediately.
Right.
But yeah, you were over at when we recorded the show last week, there was the UFC on. I kind of hit the pause button on that and we restarted it. And
then we watched it.
We watched a little bit of it and
gambled.
I'll see if I can make a fight fan out of you. So I put together just, you know, I thought about, you know, some of the best fights that I've ever seen, and I threw them up there. So maybe I'll put them up in the show thread too. If people want to know that, let me know what I think are some of the best fights of all time. And you probably have to like subscribe to UFC Fight Packs, which is kind of like Netflix for fight games.
Yeah.
But yeah, you can just cancel the first month or whatever, or get your free first month and then cancel it or whatever. And
I found a couple of Frankie Edgar fights.
Yeah,
which were fun to watch.
He's really fun because he's very good, but he gets hit a lot.
He does. Yeah.
You know, that's the thing. Like
that makes a good fight.
Exactly. Like he's going after it. He never gets tired. He gets after it. He's like a buzzsaw. He's just always in your face, and then he'll just run face first into a punch. You know, and then you have to watch him recover and struggle. It's literally like watching like a Rocky movie,
right?
Like where Rocky's just like you just don't think it's not realistic because no human could take this amount of damage and still continue fighting.
That's Frankie Edgar.
He does for Frankie. I patterned my well not this part of it, but I patterned a lot of my stuff after Frankie Edgar because he's a guy who probably could fight at 135 pounds, but he was the 155 champion at one point,
okay.
So he was a champ up two weight classes from probably where he should be.
Another point of order, we're going to have the PokerCast Fantasy Football League again this year. $100 entry was last year. We had 12 teams, I believe, last year. It was a lot of fun. I know you're not a
I don't know the American
guy,
hand egg.
But we have a new sports gambler in our midst. Maybe he might
want to... We're in the midst of baseball season, though. I don't know anything about football until like a month.
You didn't know anything about baseball
exactly.
either.
So I need to wait like a month or so in
to learn
when baseball ends, and I'm like got that itch.
Yeah.
To bet on things that I can't control.
Well, we'll have started by then, I'm sure. But head on over to the Pokercast forum if you want to get involved. $100 is usually the entry fee. It's a lot of fun each year. The Pokercast Fantasy Football League, jump in there. All right, let's get to the mailbag.
And now.
That right there is the mail. Now let's talk about the mail. Can we talk about the mail, please, Malcolm? I'm dying to talk about the mail with you all day, okay?
Mailbag. Email number
one. Kevlin writes, hello from Austin, Texas. I believe I'm more than 9 miles from Kel's. Been a fan since nearly the beginning and have enjoyed pretty much all the content you offer. I work nights, so the podcast helps keep my brain awake and running during shifts. I'm a fishy casual player that used to play a lot of $5 to $10 tourneys on Full Tilt. I'd love to play some now, so my question to you guys is this. What's the best site I could play on currently in the U.S.?
Ignition Poker? Is that the
Ignition
one?
Ignition Poker? To be honest, I wouldn't have any large amount of money on many of the sites.
Says he's playing $5 tournaments.
He's not playing, yeah. So if he's going to put $200 or $300 on there, I think ACR.
You wouldn't even have to bother to do that. You put $50 on there.
You're playing,
and then play $5 tournaments
bank
until
one.
Your bankroll runs out, or you bank one, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there's no,
Bovada, who we talked about moving to Ignition Poker, ACR are the only two that I really have any kind of idea that there's traffic at if you want to play tourneys.
Right.
So those are the two.
Unless you feel like moving to New Jersey from
right.
Texas.
Right, unless you're, yeah. But he's not. He's in Austin, Texas. So, yeah, those are the two that we would suggest.
Email number 2.
Alan writes, Jordan Christos, just to let you know, I'm one of the players that have had to play with this asswipe in the past, and he and the fact that the shitheads from Full Tilt were allowed to play this year is the main reason I didn't play the main event this year. I haven't been back to Rio since Howard Letter was seen earlier this year. I usually play two or three events a year along with quite a bit of cash. Both of these are BS. Thanks for the great podcasts over the years. Yeah, he's Jordan Christos, not a popular dude.
He's polarizing, I believe, is the term.
It's a good poker term
that they use these days.
Email number 3.
David writes in, "Hi guys, I've been enjoying your show from a sunny garden in the UK. I wanted to talk about hands in the big blind when it's checked around. Playing, I assume it means limped around, but maybe they use different terminology in the UK. Playing live and online in the past hands, say 10-6 that I can check for free. I obviously wouldn't play this usually. Well, I would hope not. Quite a few times, say, I flop trips, for example. When there's action, I'm outkicked and I lose with a hand I wouldn't normally play. Or I get involved with the big blind or the small blind hand because it was cheap to enter the pot with a crap hand. I know we need to be careful with hands from the blinds, but I find it to be a tough situation. How do you guys go about these situations? Great show. Thanks." I'll start, I guess.
Sure.
So, yeah, I mean, a lot of the times... You know, obviously if it's for free and you can check your option, you're basically just hoping to hit a monster, right? Especially if you're in a multi-way pot and you hit trips, for example. But the main thing is when the pot is small and you're playing no limit, which I'm assuming that this is the case, you don't want to lose a lot of money without a huge hand. So if you do flop something like 3-10s, you have to be aware that people like to limp with hands that queen-10, jack-10, and 10-9. And these are the most common hands that people are going to limp in with. And so, you know, it's fine to bet. It's fine to call a bet. It's probably fine to call two bets. But if the guy's firing multiple barrels at you, something like 3-10s with a 6 doesn't look so appetizing anymore.
There's always the old poker axiom, never go broke in a pot.
Unraised pot. I think that's Super System 1. Yeah.
It's Super System 1, and it's true to this, I think. I mean,
right.
I you're obviously going to be playing for a small pot. Why are you trying to lose all your chips in a spot where there's not much to win?
Right. Generally. I mean, if it comes 10-10-6 and...
That's different. You get it in.
There's like an 8 on the turn and you lose to 10-8 or something like that, then that's, you know, it goes so far. But yeah, I mean, that's the whole point. When you're, you know, Donnie talked a little about this and it was in the context of the PLO when he talked about bottom set. Now, bottom set and PLO, not considered a hand that you want to just pile tons of chips into. But because it was three bet
heads
pre-flop,
up specific to an opponent.
Yeah, well, it was also
pre-flop.
Heads up. It was three bet yeah. pre-flop, so that makes. So you're always thinking about what we call stack to pot ratio, which is basically the more that's in your stack relative to the pot. It's not what's actually in your stack relative to the blinds. It's what's relative into the pot when the action's going down. So when you've got multi-way pots and a small pot, then you need a big hand to put all your chips in the middle.
Yeah, the other thing I would say is these hands are going to teach you how to play marginal hands too. So don't automatically think, look at this like a negative.
That's
because
a great point.
You're going to play marginal hands with hands that you decide to play with.
Right.
But learning how to play marginal hands when you flop with the 10-6, the 10-7, the jack 6, whatever you have, is going to do you a world of good when you do have a marginal hand that you decided to play on purpose.
And playing out of position too, because of course you're playing out of position always when you're in the blinds.
Email number 004.
That's Adam's favorite, but I'm going to read it. Ian writes, "Hi gents, I wanted to get a take on a situation that arose in my local casino. It's a 1-2 game in British pounds. It goes once a week, and most weeks it's the same people there. There was a guy to my immediate left. I don't know to speak to, but I've seen him enough to be a decent bloke, polite to dealers and staff, and he's a good guy whether he wins or loses, and let's call him John. But for some reason, it's obvious that a couple of other guys at the table don't like him for some reason. They make remarks about his play, and these guys are not pillars of society, let's say. John and I get into a pot heads up, and I've raised his river bet all in. We're both about 400 pounds deep at the start of the hand, and my bet puts him all in. He's thinking for about 20 seconds, and these guys start making comments to each other like, this place closes in 4 hours, and you know you're just going to fold, so just do it. The dealer, who's been chatty with these guys, turns to them to talk about something unrelated, and just as John turns his hand face up and says to himself, I can't call, and he pushes it towards the muck. As I like the guy, I turned over my better hand for him and for anyone else to see and put it down. When the dealer starts pushing the pot my way, the other guy starts speaking up to the dealer saying, what about the rest of his chips? He said call. To which John says, I didn't say call. I said I can't call. However, these guys are adamant that he said call and say to the dealer that he said call. And now the dealer is asking John if he said call. And again, he says no. For whatever reason, the dealer was young or pressured or wanted to impress these guys. He now says, I think I heard you say call too. And to John's disbelief, he calls over the floorman who's going to rule in favor of these guys because, of course, the dealer's backing them up. Here's my question. I know he said, I can't call, but if I say that to the floorman, and hopefully as the recipient of the pot, my opinion will count more so John won't have to pay the all-in bet, but will the rest of the table now think we are soft-playing each other because of this and change the table dynamic, and I'm one of the people that they don't want to play with now or be the one ostracized? Or should I keep my mouth shut, play dumb, and try to give John back his lost chips either off the table or some other way? Part of me is thinking that I've been on the receiving end of a bad decision before, so this will even it out, but the other half is thinking I know that this is wrong and I'm taking another man's money under false pretenses. As it turns out, I convinced the floorman of the truth, and he got to keep his chips to the anger of the other guys, and sure enough, the other guys had shit to say about me too, and they took their chips off the table as they, quote, didn't want to play with cheats, and the table broke soon after. FYI, any other casino running live games is over 90 minutes away, so it's the only place I can play. And Ian. So, Adam, your thoughts on this very awkward,
it's an
bizarre
interesting
situation.
Yeah, with a bunch of different things. First of all, if I'm playing in a casino with the same guys night after night, and one of them is 20 seconds into a pot where I've got all my chips in, and the guy's making a decision, and this guy is saying, throw your hand away, I'm going to have something to say to those guys pretty quickly. And it's not going to be in front of everybody. I'm going to take them over there and go, shut the fuck up while my money's in the middle and there's a decision being made. Because if you're going to be run over by these guys, it's not going to stop, right?
That's a really good point,
I'm going to take it upon myself to make it clear that I'm here to play and stop fucking around when my chips are in the middle, because this is, we're playing here for poker. That's serious money that you're talking about.
Yeah, it's a big pot.
It's a big pot. So that would be the first thing that I would do. I would make it clear that they're idiots for talking like that. I wouldn't use those terms, but I'd say, look, but you know, this is etiquette. Don't do this. As far as what happened, I'm going to do exactly what he did. I'm going to tell the floor man, if I clearly heard the guy say, I can't call and turn the chips over, I'm not taking the guy's chips. Yeah. Or if I'm forced to take the guy's chips, I'm going to give them back to him later.
In the parking lot.
In the parking lot, whatever. I mean, that's just wrong for that decision.
Right.
The dealers at fault here clearly as well. for not following the game. But I think that one, yeah, those are the two
Have
things.
Have you ever played? I mean, this sounds like a casino. This sounds like it's a casino.
It's like a neighborhood in the middle of, yeah.
He used the word casino, but I've never heard of a casino that's sort of run by the inmates sort of in such a way.
Yeah, I mean, it's strange. I guess it's one of those ones that's kind of in the middle of nowhere, maybe away from big cities or something. And it's the same people who, you know, do the same things. If they're picking up their chips and calling me a cheer, whatever, they clearly, I mean, I want to play with them because they're obviously stupid. They don't understand exactly what's going on. So I want to play with them, but I'm not going to, roll over.
You know, he said, you know, playing somewhere else is not an option 90 minutes away. It's a tough spot.
It's a tough spot.
Like you said, if you're going to continue playing there, then, you know, you're going to have to stand up for yourself. You're going to have to deal with these guys all the time. You can't just try to be buddies and make waves and not make waves ever.
Email number. It's number
5. Red Sox Nets 5. Dan, he writes, hey guys, I have a story that I found pretty funny that took place on Tuesday, which was day 2 of the Borgata Summer Poker Open main event in Atlantic City. I have a witty older guy on my direct left with an accent, and he's been making me laugh for a good part of the day. Someone on the other side of the table busts, and his seat is filled by Kyle Boker, formerly best known for being a top-notch poker player, now best known for folding quads in the World Series of Poker main event. If it was going to bother him about that hand, I would have done it earlier in the day. Or sorry, if I was going to bother him about that hand, I would have done it earlier in the day when I was behind him in line at Starbucks with a friend, so I knew I wasn't going to be bringing it up at the table. Shortly after sitting down, Kyle raises all in on a flop, and a player tanks for a long time before folding, claiming ace-king on a king-high, relatively dry board. That's when the guy to my left pipes up, oh my god, now I understand. When you sit down, I was ready to make fun of you, make fun of your fold, but now no one call you for the next 2 years. It's the most brilliant fold ever. This metagame is so seek. I started cracking up, and I think I even saw the normally very serious and stoic Kyle Boker crack a smile. After laughing, though, I thought back to the other time I played with Kyle. He sat down in a Parks $1,100 tournament and 3-bet the first 3 or 4 hands he was dealt, and then locked it down and played pretty nitty. One of the first things he did after sitting in this tournament was to rip 60K all in at 600, 1200 from the big blind over a cutoff limp, button limp, and small blind limp. All of them covered him. Again, he settled down and played pretty nitty. He got me thinking, after all, he was the one who showed quads and then seeked out a reporter to tell him he folded quads. I began to seriously wonder if Kyle is a big fan of doing some seemingly crazy things simply to gain the equity of seeming like a wild man. I'm starting to think it's possible he knew the quad spot was close, and rather than calling off, because how can you ever fold quads, he decided to fold. Let everybody in the world know he folded and hope it benefits him in some way in the future. This is definitely a crazy theory, but based on my experience, it wouldn't surprise me if there's more to this fold than just thinking that he must have run into a straight flush. Sorry for the lengthy email. I love the show, and it does a great job distracting me when I have to take the 2.5-hour trip to Atlantic City. Terrence, don't give up poker. It's in your blood. Ross, don't give up your crazy air horns and cash register machine sounds for the Roscoe Report intro. No matter what else anybody says, Adam, don't give up on saying email number 4 is your favorite. Keep up the work, good work, guys. Dan Sunig. That's a pretty far-fetched, I think, to say he's going to fold the quads in a tournament, so he's going to gain some equity by doing the things that he was doing anyway.
Right, and you know, when you talk about ripping it in at the 60K at 600, 1200 for the first hand of the tournament or something, that is an image play that I think is reasonable. I mean, especially if this is like, say, a $100 tournament, and you know, if at the end of the night you're going to be playing 10 times the stakes, that's a different story. I mean, I think that's a reasonable thing to do. I mean, he might have had something like just ace 10 or something like that, and it doesn't cost a ton of equity. Mike Carroll used to talk about this stuff all the time, right? You know, he would sit down at a cash game table, and, you know, the very first hand he would, like, raise and draw 5 and, you know, and whatever, some sort of crazy nonsense.
He did stupid shit, like, I played a bunch with him in there. He would limp, and then everybody would limp, and he'd fold his hand just before the flop came out, just throw it in the
Right, you know, just kind of like, this is my crazy wild shtick. But of course, if everybody pretty quickly realizes that things
it's not
our shtick.
Exactly.
Email number 6.
Dice Pops writes, listening to the interview 2 weeks ago, trying to sympathize with her, I believe.
This is Daniel Anderson.
Daniel Anderson. I found myself thinking, hey, I lost 10 times that amount in 2008 with the $350,000 in the devaluation of our home and $250,000 in the 401k. So shut the heck up. You know, caveat emptor or something like that. I didn't write that email as I thought it was sour grapes to punch some people in Congress, Dodd-Frank, in the snout for passing horrible legislation or to be, quote, physically ill when seeing them or hearing their names. When T-Chan brought it up on this week's show, I felt better about sending the email so you guys could discuss American politics again, as it makes me laugh when Canadians talk politics. I think he's trolling you.
I think he is.
China!
Let's not even talk. Let's just move on, because that's what he's trying to get us to do, really.
Email number
7.
Brian says, greeting Pokercast bros. I'm writing from New York City, roughly 25.5 million poker racks from Kells. Oh, I hope he really did the math on this. And have been listening to the show since T joined on. Oh, I like this guy already. Adam, does Vancouver not have the Waze app? Seriously cut down on your Popo run-ins.
The app store for Waze right now.
You don't have Waze? Oh, Waze is great. Yeah, Waze basically is crowdsourced reporting for things like, if there's construction and the traffic slowed to a halt. It basically says it's basically a way for people to crash their cars by tapping buttons on their phone while they're driving. but it's great in a lot of cities because, if you see a cop on the side of the road, you just hit the cop button and then all the other users know that there's a cop there. Or if there's traffic in an area because, a semi crashed into a wall or something like that.
I would pay so much money for this.
Well, luckily it's free.
I would pay a lot of money.
You can download Waze. W-A-Z-E on Waze.
Downloading it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anyway, to give some background, I'm 28 and have been seriously, quote unquote, playing recreational poker for 2.5 years. Outside of the occasional trips to Borgata or Foxwoods, I play in backroom underground poker games around 2 nights a week just outside of Manhattan. I wonder if our listener from last week deals to him.
Yeah.
I started out playing small stakes tournament and have recently transitioned to 95% cash games.
Attaboy.
So about cash games, they're high rake, the dealer tips are very large, 5-5 no limit with optional $10 or $15 Mississippis or regular straddles. The standard buy-in is $300 to $600 but they get deeper as people rebuy. It's 10-handed. I'm consistently the youngest player at the table. Most guys are in their 50s and 60s with a lot of cash or 40-plus degens. And there's a decent amount of limping with a bunch of calling stations. Sounds like a good game. So despite the high rake and limited bankroll compared to the other players, I feel like I have an edge in these games. I've run 30 big blinds an hour over the last 3 months, which is obviously a small sample size. I recently caused a stink about guys checking their hands down to the river to be nice to one another. This happens maybe once or twice a night. They say things like, we've been playing together for a long time. My point was that won't happen with me, and it is a gray area of collusion. Am I right to be annoyed by this, or should I suck it up and keep my mouth shut?
Should we answer this one?
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah, you should not rock the boat, in my opinion.
Yep.
Don't do it. Don't ever do it, because it's a snowball effect where you're soon not playing poker. I learned this lesson myself.
Mm-hmm.
You need to play hard against everybody, even your best buddy if he's in the game. Look at Antonio and Phil. When they get going, they'll go right after each other. If generally the people that do this are the people that you want to be playing against, and you don't want to scare them off. However, they can ruin a game if it happens too much.
And these are the guys who have been in a game for a while. Like, what they tell you is true. They've been playing against each other for a while. They don't really want to take each other's bankrolls. There are some small collusion effects when you get into
sure.
a three-way pot with these people, right? So, they have a little bit more incentive to bet you out of the pot so that they can get it heads up and check it down. So you will sort of be quote-unquote colluded against, but most of the time these guys are so bad it doesn't matter. You just kind of take it. This is part of the deal when it comes to private games. And if you're a stickler for the rules, private games aren't for you.
Aren't your
like
thing.
I'm a rules guy, but I know this about myself, and so I play casinos and
right.
I play online poker. So I know this about myself. I know this stuff drives me crazy too. But if I were in a private game and I wanted to win and I lived in New York City where I can't get to a casino, I would keep my mouth shut. The second question, so is a two-parter from Brian. He writes, should I do the Mississippi? I normally follow the rule of not putting in chips unless I have to. A standard preflop raise and 3-bet needs to be significantly higher than the book standards to get people to fold. So if I button straddle and I 3-bet, I'm risking a significant portion of my stack on one hand. He goes on to say, any other tips? And he says he loves the show, enjoys the Ross Report, and would love to have the Ross read the hands, which we got away from, but we'll see. We'll see if Ross is allowed to narrate his own hands properly. But Mississippi straddle, Adam.
You should Mississippi straddle. It's getting money in with position. Yes, it's putting money in the pot when you don't have to. It's a straddle, I understand, but you're in a fantastic position. I believe if you're a good player, you're going to get equity in that Mississippi straddle, and it's a good thing to learn how to play, especially if you're going to be playing in private games. They're played even casinos now, so learn how to play by putting blind in position. I would say
I'll disagree with you slightly, because I think the Mississippi straddle is a bit overrated in no limit. In PLO...
Oh, that's a good point.
In PLO, yeah. It's a different story because...
equities are closer.
As Ross has pointed out, the most you can better raise is the size of the pot, and so you want to advance the pot when you're in the
position. That's correct.
So when you're playing no limit, you can just bet whatever you want anyway. You don't need the Mississippi to do that, especially when you're on the button. You know, you don't have to put the extra money in. But the positive side of Mississippi is it makes you look like an action player. It costs very little in EV. So it's questionable. Like, it also depends how deep you are. If you're more deep, it's better, obviously. If you're only like 200 deep and you're playing 5-5, then you're probably losing money actually on the Mississippi. So yeah, I mean, if you're playing deep, definitely Mississippi, or if you just want to be perceived as an action player, which again, we've talked about this a lot. If you're in an underground game, you want to be perceived as an action player.
All right. That's going to do it for the mail. We got a bunch more, some voicemails as well. We'll get to them next week. Oh, we'll try and do a show on Wednesday next week. So we're going to try and do.
We'll
that's
see,
a good day for you.
We've tried to, Wednesday we can absolutely do. So, we'll get to that, and we'll see what kind of guests we can pick up for the week too, but
perfect. Let's do that. 140 or less, Ross.
It's 140 characters. That's it. I love hashtags. I love all of them.
Terrence Chan
needs more than 140 characters to express himself.
140 or less.
Jason Mercier tweeted a picture of a Tesla at a Tesla dealership thanking Jay Tilla the Killa. Jennifer Tilly, of course. You're the best. Poker Night TV. Is he saying that he beat Miss Tilly out of a Tesla in the cash game?
He beat her out of a lot of money.
And then he took to Twitter and took a picture of the Tesla he bought with it? Or is he just picking a stock picture of a Tesla and maybe making a joke?
No, I'm pretty sure he took that picture. I'm pretty sure that's what he's inferring, is that he
won
that. She helped him.
She's got to be in on it, or at
she's
least...
Gotta, I was
yeah,
going to say, like,
hope
if
that's
you,
cool
of all the people that you would
she'd
needle
cool,
for,
yeah.
like, that's the last, like, way down at the bottom of the list.
If unprovoked
so
deal, yeah.
Exactly. So I have to think that she's...
She's okay with
yeah,
it.
Yeah, he's giving him the business and that she's in on it.
Moshin Charania. Is that how I speak?
Charania.
Charania. Chicago Cards, flying to at SHRPO. Worst case scenario, I catch the Zika virus. Best case scenario, Dan Heimiller and Kathy Liebert invite me to karaoke.
That would be a karaoke.
That would be a good karaoke you want to go to.
I'm not going
to
go to a lot of karaoke's. I would go to the Dan Heimiller.
Heimiller's my hero. The guy is hilarious. We got to get him on the show. He's his old website. He pokes fun at himself.
The website is great. I don't know the address, but yeah, Google Dan Heimiller.
DanHeimiller.com, or if website. It's still up. I don't know if it's still
up. Yeah, it's fantastic. It's like a GeoCities site out of the 90s, and it's hilarious.
It's pretty good. Anything else, T or Roscoe? You got 140 for less over there for us?
Yeah, we got our weekly Pokercast haiku.
Oh,
Daniel Levine. It says, spin and go winner, proves tournaments can't be beat. Everything's solid.
Is that haiku?
Everything's solid.
All right. We'll take
it. Where
are
we going to let that go? All right.
I don't really understand it, though, honestly. Everything's solid.
Let's get to the Ross Report.
All right.
Good old Roscoe. You're glad he's all right.
Hey, boy, you gotta pick your spots good, you gotta make hay while the sun shines. Hey, oh, dear. You dipstick!
It's time for a Roscoe Report.
All right, the appeal of Quick Pro concept of the week, Roscoe.
Is river calls.
It's calling in the river.
We've done this topic before, but it's still interesting. Should I try and...
Sure.
Do I have permission to attempt to,
to
read
do your
to
own,
hand?
Do your
you got
own
one
hand?
Shot. You got one
you
shot.
You got one shot. Let's see how well you do. Do not miss a chance.
Mom's spaghetti is going down.
Mom's spaghetti. All right. I am the hero in the cutoff with $224 at a 50-cent $1 PLO Zoom game. Under the gun is the villain in this hand. He has more than me, actually. He has me covered. He has over 300 big blinds. So, as I said, I'm in the cutoff. I am dealt the king-king, queen-four with the queen-high suit. Under the gun raises full pot. I call in the cutoff with my unsuited kings, or not well-suited kings. The flop is queen-three.
The button calls behind you.
Oh, he does. Oh, God. I think I have my privileges taken away.
So we got a three-way pot.
All right.
Yeah, three-way pot. Button calls. I'm in the cutoff. The flop is queen-three-jack with the queen-jack of hearts. Under the gun, bets out 855, and I call 855.
I call.
Yeah, and it's with the $12 pot. So would you peel here?
Okay, so you have top pair.
Top pair and an over pair. And three to
over pair,
queen high flush.
Backdoor spade draw. You have the king of hearts blocker to the queen jack of hearts, three of spades flop. If I call here, it's not for the current equity, I think.
You're kind of floating-ish,
yeah,
right? It's hard to really manufacture a lot of great turn cards here, right? Like, so most of the turn
King's
cards that improve
set,
you,
like, yeah.
Yeah, if you manage to make a set, somebody else probably, you know, might make a straight. I mean, there's not a lot of great turn cards, but you are in position on the preflop better. If you think he's just like c-betting aces, you can take this pot away from him a lot of the time. So I think
this
I'm
is,
okay
yeah,
with the call.
This is going to depend on the guy, if I have any history with the guy who
I
led.
Hate that there's a guy behind me, but hopefully he just doesn't get frisky too often.
If the guy is going to give up on the turn when I call in position, then I'm more likely to call here. If he's not, and he's kind of a guy who likes to, you know,
I feel like getting raised behind is more unlikely based on the fact that I have a queen and I have the king of hearts. I can't think of too many hands where he would just start potting it.
True. Yeah. I mean, if it's a pure heads up pot, then I would absolutely call 100% of the time. The guy behind me, it concerns me a little bit, but like you said, he's not too likely to get involved.
Okay. The flop again, queen of hearts, jack of hearts, three of spades.
Yeah. The turn is the deuce of spades. There's $30 in the pot now. So it improves me to a flush draw. Doesn't change that much. Actually, it helps me. It's a pretty good card for me. So he leads out again for 20 into 30, pretty decent sized bet, and I peel again.
Yeah, I don't think I'd want to raise there as a bluff. I think it would smell pretty bad because you're going to be that's a blank, so you're going to be raising the flop with most of the hands that you're going to raise the turn with in that spot.
The river is a four, not really changing anything
Off
except giving me a top and third pair. So the pot is $70, and under the gun bets out. For a third time, $40.
Boy.
So this one I don't like on the river much, I don't think.
This guy's
going to fire three barrels on this flop and then bets, you know, two-thirds pot. I think I'm probably going to fold
here.
I
think on the turn we're mostly suspecting that we're beat, but just the fact that there are enough good rivers that can come either as bluffs or as legit value hands is sort of the reason why we're calling the turn. And so when the river fails to improve us, well, I mean, it technically improved us, but when the river really doesn't make us anything big, I think I fold the river.
I think I fold the river too, unless it's a specific case with.
But
the
on
player.
The other hand, I mean, every draw missed. You know.
You block
barreling away with
this is true.
You know, we're talking with Donnie, and he was saying your off cards sort of matter in this spot, and you block some of the draws, right? So you block with the king
of
hearts,
the king 10-9 thing.
You
of
block
that, yeah.
with the kings with the straight draw. You block with the queen four spades.
Look at you learning from the expert.
Yeah, the master is here spinning knowledge on me. I'm going to learn. So I think his draws are pretty small part of his range compared to what might happen. You know, if you didn't have that specific hand. So I think I'm probably folding. What did you end up? You called and
Like folding.
What did he have?
He actually flopped top set. He had like ace queen queen X.
Oh, you. Case queen rolled off.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Next hand.
Okay. The next hand.
Can I do this one?
Sure.
Okay.
I'm looking for it. It didn't pop up for me.
Right. Again, 50 cent a dollar. You are under the gun. You have the ace, ace, eight, three spades. Ace, eight, three of spades. Ace of diamonds. Ace, ace, eight, three. Raise under the gun. You do. Fold the cutoff flats, everybody else folds. Two to the flop, 5-4 deuce, two hearts. The five deuce of hearts, you flop a wheel with the ace three. You check, he bets $4, you raise to 18, and he calls. The turn is about the worst card, the eight of hearts. So now it is 5-4 deuce, eight of hearts on the turn, completes a flush. You check, he checks. The river is another eight, gets even worse. You check, he bets full pot, and you call the full pot bet.
I don't think I would have check raised the flop. I
wouldn't either.
Yeah, like we have a hand that basically cannot improve.
The reason I did that is because he had like it was like 40% VPIP over like a decent amount of hands.
Yeah,
what's he gonna do? He's just gonna fold when he misses, right? Like he's just gonna like if he has nothing, then he's just going to fold. In which case, you don't really gain anything. But if he has something, you're gonna get like punished really.
You're
hard.
Gonna lose a really big pot.
I don't think I would be building a pot here with this having flopped like the second nuts and no redraw.
I think I might lead like if that
I think
flop
that's
comes,
fine.
I'm gonna lead.
I think it's fine to lead
half pot kind of thing, and then reevaluate from there.
But then you get runouts like this. Like first the flush comes, and then the board pairs, and so.
I think so. When he bombs the river, $43 into 45 after check on the turn, I'm pretty much folding this every time, I think.
Yeah, I understand why you called probably because you have an eight in your hand and you're kind of blocking those full houses. But, he could just have a boat.
Or he could have nothing. What did he have?
He had jack, deuce, deuce.
He had the full
mini
house.
Boat.
The full house.
Off the bottom set. Got full value.
Okay. Yeah, I think I'm probably going to fold there. All right.
Weird hand.
You're supposed to lose some money, but it's supposed to be less money, I think.
Terrence, why don't all three of us read one?
Oh, how
should we take? We'll read each street?
Oh, boy. I am. I'm not the hand history guy, so let's see. I'm seeing this for the first time. This looks like it's 50 cent dollar. PLO, of course. You are dealt the 9-8-6-4 with a suited 9
in the cutoff.
And so it's folded to you, and you raise it to
$3. I don't play well.
You raise it to $3. I think that's fine. And the big blind calls. The flop comes 10-9-5 with the 10-5 of diamonds. So what do we got here? We've got a 9-high flush draw, second pair, and a bottom-end gut shot.
It warmed my feelings up night.
See, this is why we should read this, so you could just throw drops in here all the time. The big blind, your only opponent checks. You bet about two-thirds of the pot, $4, and he calls.
So let's talk about that street. I like the bet. I think you flop a bunch of draws. Yeah, they're nothing much to the
you
nuts.
Don't really know what you want, but it's
you don't know
it's
what
enough.
You want. But I think you can bet that flop. I like that. For sure. And the raise pre.
And you know, this is a flop that kind of hits your range like a lot of the time. So the turn is a 3 of hearts, so that brings in backdoor hearts. 10-9-5-3, 2 hearts, 2 diamonds. The big blind checks, and you bet $9, which is roughly about like 67% of the pot, like two-thirds of the pot there.
I didn't want to interrupt, but I think I'm checking this turn. I think we have second pair. Again, with the draws, the guy, he's sticky in this. He check called the flop, which means, you know, he's got a piece of this at some point. It's one of those 9, 10, 5. It's a board that hit a lot of people. I don't think I want to get check raised here because I do have some equity. I'd probably lean to checking here.
I don't mind barreling too much just because I'm a barrel happy kind of dude. Like he hasn't shown any, like I think if he had like a really big draw on the flop, he would have just tried to play it and raise it as such. So if, you know, this card being a relative blank makes me inclined towards barreling again, just because he didn't show me anything on the flop. So I like the bet, but the big blind does check raise to $36. And you call. So, Ross, I'm kind of curious about this call. Like, it's a fairly large bet. None of your draws are to the nuts, and you don't have much of a hand here. So, I'm not sure I like this call of the check raise.
I think that I had some history with this guy, and I knew that he was quite aggressive. But it's impossible for me to be drawing dead here.
Right. Well, any offsuit deuce does give you the nuts, and then I mean it's unlikely that he has you blocked in every direction. So, okay, fair enough. The river is a 9 of clubs.
Pairs the board.
Pairs the board. So the final board is 10-9-5-3-9, and the big blind bets $45. You are there with just trip nines and an 8 kicker. So
trip nines, no kickers. You're bluff catching.
And you decide to call. Adam, what do you think about the call here?
So I think once he calls the turn, I think with the turn bringing another flush draw, I think this is a real draw-heavy board. I think people are going to make this move with a bunch of combo draws on the turn. Mm-hmm. So I think as played, I fold the turn, but once he calls the turn and I make three nines in the river, I'm more inclined to call here.
Yeah, it's an interesting bet sizing. So, sorry.
Nothing makes it.
The bet sizing here is just barely over half the pot. There was $88 going to the river. The big blind bet's 45. I'm trying to think of the kinds of hands that would bet half pot here, and I don't really understand what they are. I mean, I guess they're baby full houses. Things like pocket fives are definitely in the mix. Pocket threes somehow, if, you know.
Miss draws, trying to look strong.
Yeah, so... This is kind of gross. I wish now that you know, obviously, like I said, I wouldn't have called the turn either. I'm with you on that one. I don't really know what I would do here. I think I would just give up on the river, but I'm not sure.
I think I'm calling. Once I call the turn, I think I'm calling the river in that spot.
Well, Ross, you've obviously called.
I called, and he was getting snaky on me with the old king 8-3.
Wow.
King 8-3.
He had king high diamonds.
Ah.
Okay. Well, yeah, I mean... That's not a greatly well played hand by him. Part.
He had one future blocker to the straight.
That's right.
Yes.
The eight.
Future blocker. There you go.
Indeed.
Cool.
All right. That's going to be the Roscoe Report for this week. Thanks to everybody who came together to do this fine show. Terrence, for hosting us here at your apartment, and Roscoe for jumping in on the production side. Mr. Dani Stern for sitting in. First couple of segments, that was a lot of fun. I'm glad we did that with him. And to you for listening to the show. Much
I need to go. Is this enough?
We need you over in our forum. Head on over. Sign up for the Fantasy Football League and comment on this week's show thread. We did a combo show this week. We're not your training is pretty serious at this point. We're getting stepped up to a month away
combo
from your
show,
fight.
AKA regular show.
This one's a AKA regular. But I would think we
might be splitting some shows up in the future because it just it makes things a little and you get a PokerCast twice a week. You get a guest interview and you get the in case you missed.
I heard good things and bad things about that. Yeah. Some people like because they listen to several podcasts and they want to be able to switch back and forth. They don't feel like they're committed to the one show for 3 hours. Yeah. So.
Indeed.
I don't know when the last time I made it through a three-hour podcast is, personally, other than this one.
Yeah.
But thank you to you guys who do it.
But next week, we're going to try and have Kate Hall on. We're going to talk to her about all kinds of stuff, her World Series of Poker and different things going on in the poker world. We'll talk to her, hopefully. This week, she was busy down at the SRPO, so hopefully that'll be
Hopefully we'll be talking about somebody who won a bunch of money, and she'll be in a better mood. It'll be a great mood.
Until then, thank you so much for listening. We'll talk to you soon. Roscoe drop?
I
ready
did.
To go?
Yeah, let me look.
Bacon? Bacon.
Yeah. Bacon. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
Ready?